Stand by for the broadcast, ladies and gentlemen. Coming up next, Forbidden History Live. What they didn't want you to know that we tell right here. And special today, the Gospel of the Essenes on the Ten Commandments and a whole lot more. Please note that the following views and opinions expressed on this program are not necessarily the views nor the opinions of the Master Force Group, YouTube.com, Free America Radio Network, our sponsors, our partners, and MFG is a private society. Nothing here is ever to be construed as hate, medical, nor legal advice. And listen to the Forbidden History prime time 7 days a week right here on TheRealPublicRadio.net, because hidden beneath the sands of time lies the greatest of all mysteries. It's the Forbidden History. Unearth for yourself the secret truths that lie hidden just beneath the surface below our feet. What is it that the powers that be do not want you or I to know? Come and journey with us as we explore and dare to know, because it's all right here, coming your way, 7 days a week on TheRealPublicRadio.net, Free America Radio Network, and on YouTube.com at Forbidden History Live and NinjaCat111 as the Forbidden History Chronicles and the old archives from last year, June 21st, 2018, at The Forbidden History Series. Four words, The Forbidden History Series. So go check it out, ladies and gentlemen. The first 2 weeks, I rolled up my sleeve and talked about what nobody else talks about, and it's still right here coming your way as long as the earth keeps spinning. Coming to you live from Studio Z at the Lighthouse in Central Ohio and Free America Radio Network in the land of dreams, enchantments, and nightmares. It's Forbidden History Live, what they didn't want you to know that we tell right here with your host, Desert Owl. Still time to call your friends. Time, ladies and gentlemen, if you're here, because here is where we bring you the most important information on the face of the entire earth or under the earth. Here is where each week we bring you the very best in radio broadcast listening, while we reveal the greater secrets and the deeper mysteries of life. Yet the one question that will always remain will be this: can you handle the truth as it will be presented here? Morgan, or at the afternoon, or in the evening, or in the future, wherever you are around the world, I don't know if you can handle the truth. I don't even know if you want the truth, because the truth, it is stranger than fiction, yet the truth can set you free, but it will make you a fugitive within your own land. So stand by. It's Forbidden History Live, coming up next. And today we will be doing part two on the Gospel of the Essenes and the Essene Ten Commandments, the story from their perspective, a little short work, and then we'll be getting into another lost writing that came out of Tibet, the Holy Gospel of the Twelve, and what happened on the mountain with Peter, James, and John when they saw the great light. So we've got something in store for you coming up right away. You did tell your friends? Come on, you wanted to know, right? Go tell your friends right now, ladies and gentlemen. We still have time. Well, we have very little time, but while you got the time, go tell them. That way, good to have you. Welcome to the broadcast, ladies and gentlemen. Desert Owl, bird who sees in the night, and I see too much. And I wish I could find that proverbial blue pill, but it's not going to happen. We have to learn how to deal with our reality. That's all we have, of course, is to deal with our reality now. And our days are so numbered. Hope you all watched Dane Wigginton yesterday. It's that's the wake-up program, if there ever was one, for our state of affairs on planet Earth. It's game over. You know, the people love the game. Well, it's game over, you know, and while they're watching the game, as the definition for sports is found in Noah Webster's first American dictionary of 1828, the word sports originally means diversion. Okay. Diversion. So, yeah, that's everybody was diverted, and they got you watching the left hand when you should have been watching the right hand. Okay, and all of you out there, welcome to the broadcast. And Jet, thank you for sharing the link to our broadcast, because we got no new subscribers all week. You know, it's really bizarre. We get no numbers that jive from the file on home or videos, and then when you go there, it's a different number. And no subscribers. Once they block me from being able to subscribe to other channels, which is, you know, self-promotion, it's a way we can promote, then, you know, therefore, we've been, you know, basically blackballed, you know, it's a way to put it. When you no longer can promote, you can't subscribe. I have channels out there I just recently found I wanted to subscribe to because I wanted their content, you know, and so I'm literally, you know, they said that whenever I click on the subscribe, it pops up and says, well, You have subscribed to too many channels compared to how many people are subscribing to you, but now I can't get any subscribers, right? Go figure. Okay, Catch 22. They love it. Art Alexander, good to have you. And Jason Jenna as well. I saw your message at the top. Good to have you, all of you tuning in. And we're trying to make lemonade out of the lemons that they've handed us, you know. And it's a shame when numbers are the most basic thing on a computer, that we cannot have correct numbers, and also in a free state, you know, supposedly to be able to freely engage with others in a peaceful manner, and to subscribe to other people would be about as fundamental as you could ever ask for. What's the difference if I wanted to subscribe to a million people out there? What's the big deal? They want subscribers. I'm happy to do it, and then they see me for the first time, and they can come in. But apparently, they don't want them to see me. And that makes sense, of course, right? Of course it does. And it's just amazing. And I know we've got ninja down under at an early hour right now. It's late for her already. It's like 2 in the morning, I think. And so, Ninja, if you wanted to call in, we can start the program. Well, I'll tell you what. Can I do a few words? I wanted to just do a couple word presentations because I really want people to see the original thought. Let me do 2 words. Well, several words, but one is on a theme. It's on the theme of Superman. And Tierra Sky, hey, welcome. That's a nice, very nice name, Tierra Sky. That's like saying the royal sky. We could say the sky is royal, actually. And because it was made by the great breath of the wind and fire, by the one who made all things. He breathed, and then there was light, the Zorain, and then and so the atmosphere, our inner most atmosphere is the breath. It is the O, the big O, the oxygen, that is breathing. So I wanted to that in fact we need more than anything else. That's a fact, and so it's the stuff they don't talk about in school either. They just they told us the four elements was water, earth, air, and matter. Or excuse me, fire, right? And fire is not an element. Fire is, that's a lie then. They lied to us. And then air is not an element either. Air is the space up there, T-A, there. You see that you can hear the sound. Air is there. It's up there. But what is up there? It's predominantly oxygen and I guess what, hydrogen? So so anyway, so they lied about the air because it's correctly, well, actually gas. Gas would be the correct terminology for what's up there. What's up there is a gas. The gas goes up, the particles, the gaseous particles. So it's water, matter. So you just turn the M over from matter, and you get water in the trickery because the W is a corruption anyway. It's really viator, and then the gas and not fire. Oh, that's the biggest lie of them all. It wasn't the fourth element is not fire. Fire is not an element. It's the destruction of elements, right? And that's what they did. They destroyed the truth because the fourth element, which is the primary element, is light. Light, the atomic light that comes down, that builds everything, every structure, the atomic light, okay? And so there you go. They're right out the gate. They lied to us, ladies and gentlemen. And then I could go on talking about the plus symbols and the minus symbols. They reversed them. The multiplication and the division, they reversed them. Literally, okay? And there's so much more that I could share with you. But I want to just do a couple words for Ninja calls in. Ninja, you're going to be calling in. You want to call in right away? Just give me a heads up so I know what to do. If otherwise, I got a small list of words here before we get into the main program. I usually like to do words at first because people. Hey, Just Love, good to have you. Well, I got some answers to your questions actually, some more, and so just hang in there, okay? Because I've got like 3 3x5 cards. I did a review. We finally got that video posted. We had it all week, have to work on getting it posted. Didn't know why it wouldn't post, but Shelley did her computer magic and got it up there. And then I just was finishing the review actually early this morgan. It's not morning. You don't want to mourn. It's morgan. This morgan, that means the mother's light in the garden. That's morgan. That's the Indo-Germanic, the mother's light in the garden. You see, and they want us to be mourning, putting on black. You see how just a little slight alteration of the eshavors, the words, and then you get another meaning, just like when the judge goes into the courtroom and they say he's presiding when he's really presiding with the prosecution. They want to know if you don't have an attorney? Oh, you need to get an attorney, boy. Well, okay, so what are you, representing yourself, meaning representing yourself as a fiction, since we can only deal with corporations in that commercial court, or the prosecutor is pro-security. So you see, that's the trick. So it's really not good morning. It's good morgan, and actually, if we add the Y to the A, it's morgain, because what do you get out of the garden? You get a gain of produce. That's what you get. You get the gain. That's what you get out of a garden. So it's morgain. But morgan is closer to what they're telling us in the Hebrew, because they say gan, G-A-N is garden, but it'd be, G-A-N-N. There's always two N's. That's why man is spelt in the German with the two N's, M-A-N-N. So I'm just, we're reeling the code. That's what we do out the gate to get you stimulated with a little primer on this occultic world we have. So what's interesting is about the you know, the term Lazarus, and we see the prime root in Lazarus, Lazar, which would, Lazarus is a corruption because they didn't want us to connect it with the old covenant, because it would actually be Elazar, but Elazar, the El is a corruption out of the Babylonian Talmud, and it should be the Ul, because that means the ability to see in the night. That's the prime root of owl, right? Ul, Ulazar. So what's interesting about this prime, in other words, what it was like Yeshua, when he rose Ulazar or Lazarus from the grave, what he was really saying when he says, Lazarus, come forth, he's saying, laser, come forth. Ray of, in other words, what is the laser, right? It is a ray of light. He's saying, ray of light, come forth. Why? Because it was the picture of becoming the second born, of rising from the death of this world, of this planet, okay? And so Lazar, see, and there's the word star. And so literally another way to say it is the star. Lazar, let me type it in here, is then correctly Z-A-R is the S-T-A-R, okay? Lazar is the star. So he, well, that's what he told Abraham, that we were supposed to become like the stars up in the sky. And Tiddly, good to have you. We're supposed to be like the stars up above. And so he's saying, ray of light, become a new star, you know? And that's what the picture, and it was a type of what Yeshua was just about to do, so that anybody who could process would know, oh yeah, wait a minute, didn't, he's going to rise from the dead. He just raised Lazarus this past week, right? And he was in their grave for 4 days. On the fourth day, he rose. And that's the same case with Yeshua, because he was actually murdered on a Wednesday. And then there was the high Sabbath, which was the feast day on Thursday. And then Friday was the day the ladies went to buy herbs and spices to embalm the body. But then they had to take another rest on Saturday. So there was two Sabbaths that week. And most people don't get the story, and they think he died by the propaganda on Friday. You know, we put a propaganda film up on the board, by the way. You check it with the big question mark on it, and go look, tell me you can't find all the lies. The whole video documentary practically is nothing but one big lie. It's a propaganda piece to support the illusions, ladies and gentlemen. And Jason, good to have you. And so what we get with the anagram of Lazar, laser, okay, L-A-Z-A-R, and remember, word forms are like fluid, because you can change the vowels and get the other hidden meanings. But so literally, you can see in the anagram, okay, realize, which are, realize, you see? And so the laser in the anagram is realize, because when we become light, when we become one with the light, or are in the process of becoming, then we begin to realize many things, and it's because we've been given real eyes. That's why Yeshua healed more blind people than anything else, right? You know, what do you want, like, you know, in Jericho, where it says the father is rich, and he says to the blind man who was crying out, he heard he's going by, and he's screaming, hey, son of David, and they're saying, hey, be quiet, you know, and no, and he starts to scream louder, hey, Yeshua, he knew, and then when he's told, hey, Yeshua's calling you, go over there, he throws his coat off of him onto the ground. You think a blind man is going to throw his coat on the ground and never be able to find it again, somebody steal it? You know, no way. But he knew he was going to get a healing. He knew it. And he threw his coat on the ground. He didn't care anymore. He wanted to have his eyes restored, and he didn't need the coat from that standpoint. So that's, that's why Yeshua healed more blind people than anything else, to show us that we were blind as a creation, and that we had to put on the real eyes. And the real eyes come through having a focus. What does a laser light do? It focuses, right? It's a focusing of light. Okay. And but to correctly, Elazar, E-L-L-Z-A-R. I hope I got it spelled right. I was always bad at spelling. No, that's not a good spelling. Elazar, Z-A-R. Is that it? Elazar, that's close enough. You know what I mean. But I know the original thought. That's what's what counts here. And okay, Elazar is Ule, Ulezar. Actually, there should have been a Y in there. O O L L A Y T Z A R. Okay, the lay is the light, and the light is the star. It's the czar, and so the T is the symbol of light and sacrifice and completion, and also transformation from one state to another. And that's why he went up there on the burning tree, also known as the burning tree, and also known as the curse, and also known as the cross and the cruise. Okay, and the crew, all the, you know, these different elements in there. So there's one word, a shavor, and then now we're going to do one little. I did a series of about several programs on the movies, you know, and so I thought it'd be really good to really to point out the code and the original thought in the movie Superman. Okay. Because the Superman, are the Supperman, right? Because that's the it's representing a Jesuit, and they're Superman, you know. Wow, they can climb tall buildings in a single bound, and bullets don't hurt them. You know, and so the Supperman, what do you mean? Because every Sunday, like today, they're having their supper with the Mass, right? And while at the same time, they're having their underground feast on Saturday, right? Saturn's Day. And Roasted Scorpion, good to have you. Yeah, okay, remember, you wanted to get those copies of the Fenton Bible, right? You were checking that out. I was wondering where you've been, so hope things are going well for you. And good to have you. So we're going to define a few words in the movie Superman, okay? And because and get a pen and paper, because I don't know if I'm going to type it, you know, right there. And you got it. Okay, wonderful. I hope you're enjoying it. The Farrar Fenton Bible, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, so people she wanted to get the right one, didn't want to get the occultic version, but the one closest to the truth, and that's really fantastic. And thank you, Roasted as well. Superman. Okay, Clark Kent. We'll start with Clark Kent. So Clark, I'll put the code there because I want you to see it visually, and it'll be preserved if we don't, you know, have a problem today with the stream. Clark is cloak. Okay. And you can see that pretty obvious. You just change one vowel and you get the word cloak. And then Kent, K-E-N-T, is correctly K-E-N. Okay? And Ken means lawfulness. So literally, Clark Kent in the code means the C-L-O-A-K of lawful. The cloak of lawfulness, you see? Cloak, Ken means law. So Clark Kent, the mild manner, wouldn't hurt anybody, is under the cloak of lawfulness. He's a good guy, you know, and he's stupid even. You know, he at least puts on that pretty good act, right? But yet he's a Jesuit, you see? So the priest comes to you, oh, Jesus loves you, let's pray together, brother. And then while at the same time, they got people chained up in the basement with leg irons and, you know, being imported to, Italy for an exorcism, you know. And the dungeons underneath the Catholic churches are a fact throughout all different nations of the world, okay? Not all of them, I'm not saying all of them. And they got the underground tunnels going from a Protestant to a, Protestant to a... Vatican, or, you know, from an Islamic temple to a Catholic temple. They're all, the priesthood is in on the deal, ladies and gentlemen. And good morning, Zealot. Good to have you. Okay. And, I guess you're getting those notices. That's good. Cause I think I spaced it out today, you know, didn't think of that. So as long as you're getting notices, good. If you still need to get them, let me know. And I can tag a post-it note on my computer and I'll do a better job next time. Okay, so Clark Kent is then the cloak of lawfulness, but he's really the Superman. You know, he's the Supperman, and bullets can't hurt him. You know, bullets can't hurt him. Why? Because they're the super sovereigns. You know, Yeah, they got the secret passwords, the handshakes, the hand signals, you name it, they got it. So the word Lois Lane, okay? So Lois is two words. Three words, okay? So Lois, L-O-I-S, is the true. So it would be like this. It'd be Lo, L-O-I-S-H, okay? Lo-ish, but ish is the woman. And so it means literally, low means true, right? So it's the true woman, okay? But yet, so Lane, so then Lane is L-I-N-E, okay? Lane, and so literally what it means is the T-R-U-E-W-O-M-A-N-S, L-I-N-E, okay? The true woman's line. What is the true woman? Oh, it must be that one that is dressed up looking good, right? You've got some nice perfume on, big breasts, but yet she's Lucifer, the Lucifer in a dress, okay? And so we don't want Lucy, okay? Because Lucy, Lois Lane, is the lowish line, and that low-ish, two words, ish is Asia. The original for ish is actually A-S-H-A. There's the royal eye. You see, the woman, it represents the virgin light, the royal eye. But so we got Clark Kent, a Jesuit, and then we got Lois Lane, which is a code for, the true woman's line. And the true woman is the false woman. That's the one element right there. That's the lie. L-O means true throughout time, throughout all time, in perfection. And literally, it means the true woman's line, but it's the false woman. You see, it's the false woman. And so, and I just want to, and so in the movie, you know, which I'm not really going through, but there's one in there that's a good one, you know, and we got the Jesuit walking the rail under the subway, right? And he's walking the rail. Okay. And what do you do when he's walking, he's got to walk the rail, meaning he's got to walk straight line, right? Okay. But actually, when you get the anagram of rail, you find out and you read it backwards. He's a liar, okay? These are liars that are running our world today, right? And that's the truth is stranger than fiction, ladies and gentlemen. And so they're walking in a straight line. In fact, you know, in the movie The Exorcist, when the lady who is the star of the movie is walking past the Catholic Church courtyard, and two priests are over there talking, right? And so she stops to listen. Right in the movie The Exorcist, and so she's listening to what they're saying, and the one priest telling the other one, he's giving him a confession. He says, you know, I talked to doctors, I talked to lawyers, I talked to police, I talked to all these people. I feel like such a fraud. I don't know any one of them that has to read words backwards. You know, that's right in the movie The Exorcist. I feel like a fraud. I don't know anybody that has to read words backwards. You know. And so they're telling you right in the movie, so blatantly in Exorcist, go get it. Maybe they've edited it out. I don't know. You know, but it's okay. So Perry White, okay. Perry means to make fat, okay? And white, it represents symbolically a star. Okay, so it means a fat star. Well, that's sort of like, you know, what the attorneys are. Remember Perry Mason? Perry Mason, you know, was the fat attorney. And you know, Perry, like in a pear tree, it's a pregnant fruit, right? Because it's fat at the bottom. It's having a baby. It takes two to make a pear, right? It takes a pear to make a pregnancy, right? So they call it a pear. Two came together, you got fat. You know, it's going back to that original story of Adam and Eve, right? And Knott's Boy 24, good to have you, and enjoy the broadcast, all right? And want to welcome any of our new listeners out there on the stream around the planet, okay? And we make lemonade out of lemons that they've given us, ladies and gentlemen. So if you're hearing this stuff for the first time, well, then, you know, obviously you're hearing it for the first time because they don't go down the rabbit hole like we do anywhere else, and we're trying to define things in a way. So what did Perry White always used to say, right? He always would go, Great Caesar's ghost, great Caesar's ghost, right? And so they're bringing up Caesar from the dead, the Caesar, the keys of fire. Well, who's got the keys of fire? The Pope, the Vatican, right? They morphed themselves from a political state to a religious state. And so who's the other character in the story, right? We got Jimmy. Well, Jimmy, you know what he acts stupid, right? Jimmy's like, you know, he doesn't know nothing, and you know, he needs help up the elevator, you know. And so, but Jimmy, listen to the word. What do you want to do when you want to fix something or put the fix in, right? You Jimmy it, right? So he's like the Freemason who comes around acting like the good old boy Jimmy, and he's stupid, don't know nothing, and acts like a retard. But behind the scenes, he's really sophisticated, just like Clark Kent, you know, the cloak of lawfulness, when he's really Superman, you know, bullets can't hurt them, you know. So, Knotts, you're out up in the UK. Good to have you. We've got a global audience all the time here, and it's always fun to make new friends around the world. So welcome, and do tell your friends, okay, because I can't self-promote anymore. I can't subscribe to any channels. For some reason, it's been I subscribed to 1,000 channels, and now all of a sudden I can't subscribe to anybody anymore until I get the numbers up, apparently. But the numbers didn't grow at all this week, and I think they're jimmying my subscription count of people wanting to. So if any of you haven't subscribed yet, and you do, then let me know you subscribed. And if I don't see the numbers change, then I'll know, okay? But I assume most of you that have popped in here, I subscribed on you already, and that's why you came in, because you were doing me a courtesy of resubscribing, okay? And Michael Kilpatrick, sorry you don't think it's a planet, but a plane, like the Bible hints at. No, the Bible doesn't hint at that, actually, Michael. It is a sphere, and the best one that refers to it as a sphere over and over is Farrar Fenton's, actually, and over through several different books out of our scriptures. This is what they hid from us, you know. And in fact, okay, and just to, so I did that, just to mention, by the way, from the flat earth standpoint, you know, can you realize that if the earth was flat, you wouldn't have waves or a tide, because the waves and the tide are pulled by the moon going around the earth. So that's pretty fundamental physics, you know, and let alone there wouldn't be the seasons, nor the currents, you know, in the ocean, nor, you know, we could just go on the poles and all of, thank you. I appreciate that. So let me do a refresh over there. So anyway, you know, want to welcome our flat earthers as well, but, you know, that's, from my standpoint, that's a flat thinking, and it's not going to, you know, you can't define any of the phenomena that's happening by that. And in fact, the sun is at the center of our creation, and the earth and the moon, as well as Venus and Mars, all the planets came out of the sun. It is the mother star, and that's what we've been talking about here. Go listen to some of our back programs, and you'll find that out. Okay, it's very easily explainable, unlike, you know, the flat theory, which is just a theory. And and by the way, I got 181 subscribers now, so thank you, friends, for you know, helping me to check that out. I couldn't figure out what the problem was with that, but now we know that the count is working. And it's just like I hadn't been able to promote all week, you know, so go figure. And, obviously they can't figure, because all their counts are wrong, you know, on my main board, the homepage, and the other page, you know, has all the videos. They're all, when you open it up, it's a different number on the opening screen versus what it's posted there. So none of it makes any sense, okay? Yeah. Circle is not a globe. Okay, this is going to be a distraction, so we're going to have to, flat earthers, you know, you just, you know, all want to argue that, okay, and we can't do that here. We have an important presentation that we're making here, so, okay, but thank you for stopping by. You can listen, okay, but, you know, take your flat earth, you know, somewhere else, because it's just a distracted issue. And and it just doesn't do anything to serve, and it's not true anyway, okay? And it's I'll do a presentation on that. Sirius is just a star system up there, Art, okay? And anyway, let's get serious here, okay? And we're let me put that card over here under flat Earth, and what I just said about the tides and about the waves. You can see the pull of the moon on the earth, ladies and gentlemen. It's as simple as that. But one more, I'll give you one more clue, okay? If you go out into the middle of the ocean, once a ship starts moving away from your position, The ship goes over the edge within 4 nautical miles in any direction. You no longer can see the ship, and that's because of the curve of the Earth. Okay, so the arguments are really easy when you can look at things logically. But the idea of the flat Earth is a Vatican creation, because in the beginning, 1,000 years ago, because they were harvesting hemp and also using the Americas as a secret enclave, they wanted to put the fear in people that they would fall off the edge of the earth and or be eaten by sea monsters. And so they kept people therefore they wouldn't go out into the deep waters and find the new world, which is the old world that they have been going to for thousands of years. Even the Egyptians, which is another false name for the Mitzrayim, okay? For the Mitzrayim. So, Ninja, if you want to call in, I did those words that I wanted to share, okay? So you're welcome to call in. In the meantime, I'll stay with a couple more words while you're making your call. And I've got and then after your call, I'm going to do the answers for T-Love, okay, for Just Love, because she made a wonderful contribution with a series of questions the other day, and I just finally got a chance to review them all, and so it sparked a further thought on these particular key points that we were dealing with, okay? And so, okay, Ninja, you're calling in. I assume that you're calling in. So in the meantime, while we're waiting for Ninja, the bull, you know, I saw the bull symbolically, In another light, when I was actually listening to the conversation I was having with T-Love, and the bull is really in one standpoint. And if you let me tell you something, if you've ever stood in the middle of a field, and then you suddenly notice there was a bull in the field, you'll know that the bull is a monster. Okay, because that happened to me at age 18 when I was in Colorado. And I climbed over a barbed wire fence across a field. And by the time I got to the middle of the field, I looked over there to my left, and there was a bull. And the whole idea about the bull's eye, you know, the bull's eye. Well, when you see the bull, you see the bull's eye, because he's looking at you real close, and you see him lowering his head. And you know, you're now looking, questioning, can you make it to the other side and hop over that fence before he gores you? You know, and that's exactly what happened to me. And I was absolutely, I don't know how I made it out. You know, it's a little bit of a blur now. It's a long time ago, you know, 40 plus years ago, but literally, so the bull is the monster. And so that's what, so when Moses went up to the mountain, who was correctly Moeshan, he came back down. What do? They made a bull. Not a calf. You see, that's the lie. They made a calf. They made a bull and not a calf. And the bull is the monster. They prefer the chaos of this world, the chaotic, which is what was part of the discussion that T Love and I had. And Ninja, are you calling in? Because I'm just trying to fill space here while you're calling in. Are you calling? Give me a heads up. All right. So the word bull is as T-Love got it, is associated also with Baal. She could hear the similarity and see the similarity in the word. So Baal, you know, with the U is a corruption. It's a letter that doesn't exist. And Baal, stand by. Okay, we're standing by. All right, there we go.
G'day. Okay.
Okay, Ninja, how are you?
Pretty good. How's it going, Desert? You're very quiet. Can you?
What do you mean I'm quiet?
You're quiet. Hang on.
You can't hear me? You can't hear me?
I can hear you now. I just turned it
up. Turning it up will help. That's true. I learned that the other day as well. I didn't want to mess up to what my mistake was, but, you know, I learned it that way too, right? Mm-hmm. And Fix It Fox, good to have you. Welcome to the broadcast. Got a lot of friends stopping in.
G'day, everyone. I love all of you. I had to say it. Sorry.
That's right. It's the love is flowing. That's lava love, right?
Yes. Lava love. Okay. Yes. Before I forget, I just want to say, when you were talking about Superman, the obvious S symbol on his chest.
Oh, the serpent in the diamond,
Yes.
right?
Yes.
He's a diamond in the rough, right? And
Yes.
yeah.
Yeah, I put that in the chat, but you didn't see it.
No, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Fox, for your well wishes. Hope you're doing well as well. Please continue, Ninja.
Okay. Where to start?
Well, the start is a
Okay.
star. You see, there's the word star right there, right? Okay, that's telling us where it all began. It all came, remember I said, I just said it again.
Wow.
I say it over and over. It all started with a star, and the word start is a star. That's
Okay, so
telling
what
us,
about,
you know? It's
wow.
telling us. They want
Okay,
us to
so I
think
don't
that
even
the
have to
sun,
hardly
they want us to,
speak.
hold on. They want us to think that the
Which,
sun is a basketball in the sky, when the fact is the Earth is a child of the sun, and all the planets, other than the gaseous orbs, I think they came in from without, but clearly all of the planets and the moons came out from the sun. They're children of the sun. That's why they go around the sun, and it's a mother star. Everything came out from the light, and that's the scriptures. Somebody, wants to use the flat Earth, the scriptures to prove flat Earth. They can't do it because it's solar centric, the soul, the light. Everything came out from the light. Anybody who knows the scriptures knows that. You see? Let there be light. Yeah. And when the earth was not yet formed, within the void is the correct way. The scriptures, the first two verses, are incorrect in the King James and in the occultic versions, because what it really says is not the earth was void and without form. It was that the earth was not yet formed in the void. And then the third verse says, then the great breath moved upon the cosmic waters and breathed into the star and said, let there be light. And there was light. The breath is the spirit that breathed into the gaseous orb of the sun and ignited it. Spontaneous combustion. And then out from them, out from the sun, came all the planets and the moons. Okay? Now that's the scriptures presentation. And like I say, Farrar Fenton is the only one, not only is Fenton the only one who correctly defined the word spheres over and over throughout the scriptures, but he also defined what the King James is just calling idols when they're actually the two columns of Jochim and Boaz in the occultic masonry still today, when they were represented the twin towers, the two columns that they took down to have a ritual blood sacrifice on our planet. Whereas these two columns, as we find them in Columbia, Columbi, the two columns, see, it's in the code word, Columbia, Columbus discovers America, Columbia, Columbi, go with throttle up, and yet the astronauts are not even on the rocket because they knew they were going to blow it up to show that they're ramping up in 1986. 86 means to throw everything away. I could go on and on with the symbolism and, and dispel all the conjecture of non-thinking people. It's not a problem at all. They don't. They can't look. They can't see the symbols, nor can they read the code. But they're all experts. Of course. I'm
Wow.
sorry. Continue.
Don't apologize.
Yeah. I like people coming on here grandstanding. With their absolute. They never figured anything out themselves. They've never had a vision, but they heard something on YouTube, and therefore they think now they know something, right?
Yeah.
Because they
Yeah.
can't talk about anything else that we talk about here, you
Yeah.
know?
I love how people come on here to hear it here first. What, things that are not being spoken about anywhere else, and they try and correct you and tell you otherwise. That's I love it. Yeah.
Well, but if they can give me some substance and not just, the same rant, because
Instead of
that's all it
repeating,
is.
repeating, repeating,
Yeah,
repeating.
and
Yeah.
they and the, and it's their mantra. It's their religion. The flat Earth is their religion. That's their religion. And so either you're one of us or you're not, right? That was the classic George Bush statement after they took down the Bush family took down the Twin Towers. Either you're with us or you're against us,
Yeah,
right?
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Wow. Wow, that was awesome, Desert. Just let me recover from that for a
Well, you're
moment.
sounding better today. I'm glad. I know you were toughing it out last time you called in, and well, that was last week, I guess. That was last Sunday when you were really having it tough, and I was listening to the
Yeah.
replay. I thought it was yesterday.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah,
So
it's
that's
still
good.
just as tough. I'm just dealing with it a bit better. I'm trying not to let myself slip back back into putting looking after myself last, which I noticed I was doing today. The dog has two sore feet at the moment. I think there was an issue with the dog clipper lady. She came, like, she was a mobile dog groomer that came and parked outside and gave the dog a clip and a wash and clipped his claws. Mm-hmm. And she seemed nice enough, but now that I've had a bit of time to think about it, there's an issue with one of his claws on one of his front feet where it's broken, like snapped under the skin. Mm-hmm. And there's another issue that she aggravated that we didn't know about. I know that he's been chewing his back foot a lot lately, and he chewed it so much that, like, there could have been something stuck in there, that, you know, something tiny stuck in there. But yeah, he's been chewing it, and he broke the skin, and I don't know how she could have done it. She must have done it when she was clipping his claws, obviously. Mm-hmm. But she brought him back in and apologized and said that she aggravated something, like he had a sore from chewing. Mm-hmm. And it, yeah, and he was bleeding. And so that's fair enough, because I know the dog can be quite difficult to be, like, held in one place to get these things done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he can be a wriggly worm. but the front foot, I think there was a bit of shenanigans there. Yeah, so he's in a bit of pain, but he's dealing with it. And anyway, long story short, I soaked his feet in a bath of Epsom salt to prevent infection, and I have not done my toe for 2 days, so I'm putting myself last, and I don't want to go back to where I was a week ago, Desert. But it's getting worse. Like, I don't feel worthy of any of this at the moment, and that's what's pushing me to focus intently on working on the cosmic channel. Because mm-hmm. that brings me peace doing that.
Yeah,
I don't feel worthy because I am getting so frustrated with the situation, and I actually raised my voice at Mum again tonight because she won't let me leave her to come up this end and relax. It's always last minute, just before bed, and that's, you know, the mm-hmm. the trigger words are rest and anything to do with peace and rest and relaxation are triggers for Mum to go to get worse. And I actually raised my voice at her and said, look, can I just go up my end of the house and go to bed without getting frustrated, without being in a bad mood, please? And that set her off even more, and I walked out and shut the door.
Yeah, right. Well, and, well
yeah,
just,
I don't,
just put, you know, put it up to Yeshua and and just ask for patience. If you feel, you know, I obviously there's no way to reason with somebody that's losing exactly. their natural, cognitive ability to reason, and therefore, sometimes you may have to do that actually with that type of a quality. She should be in professional care, and you're not a professional nurse, and you're just a family member that's doing your part to take care of a family member, and yet you have no break And so naturally, you're going to have a moment where you just can't take it anymore. That's a, it's not natural to, you know, to be in your situation, and that's the reason we put out the word for you. And Tiddly was right about the silver. That's what I was going to say, to get silver for the dog. You know, if you soak it in silver, it's going to absorb inside the foot, and that's the best thing to do. You know, and there's Alyssian Confederation. Welcome as well, and.
I'll do what I can for the dog. He's in more pain than what I am with my toe at the moment. So
So anyway, I just want to get on the Chronicles real quick. Cosmic
Chronicles.
Essence.
I didn't know. I just realized when you said excuse me.
Well, I got too much going on in my head. You're doing some posting, and you are now really, we have the rhythm down for producing on the Cosmic Essence. So if you've not subscribed there, this will be where you can go and not have to listen to the long presentations to find what we already talked about in those other programs, ladies and gentlemen. And we're trying to grab as quick as we can the first two themes that we did, one on who Adam really is, the big lie, and then also who the Watchers really were, another big lie. You know, everything's a big lie, you know, and so we dispel all the fallacies here. There's a nice word, fallacy, the sea of fallacies. How did that happen, right? And so, but it's not, it's versus, myth, you know, because they made myth into something false, and myth is not something false. Myth is our story, my story, the mother's eye of, and the breath of the mother's eye, and that's our story. In the etymology there, you know, and so, but anyway, yeah, we're trying to ramp up, another channel here that will then allow you to topically find what you are looking for. And so go check it out and subscribe. And every time Ninja posts something, you'll have something there to go look at. Okay. And it's the condensed version based on topic of everything we talk about, from words to scriptures, to symbols. It's all going to be, each one have its own line. One line for symbols, alphabet.
Yeah, I need to go and have a play around with that and make it pretty again, because, I need to organize it. But,
right. So she's just doing it, and she does that while she's taking care of her mom 24/7 and not getting any relief from anyone, anywhere, you know, and no money to save so she can relocate. So, if you want to get our documents, you know, Ninja, be glad to send them to you. We give her half of any donation that comes in for our documents, okay?
Thank you. I don't want to get emotional, so I won't. I was just going to say, just one more thing on this topic. The most frustrating thing, or one of the many, actually, is that, when I do get a break, for those who don't know, I get two-hour breaks and one-hour break every week. That's it, 5 hours a week. The respite care workers that come, they will explain to mum exactly the same things in exactly the same way that I'm stuck with on repeat, like the rest of the time, and mum instantly understands them. That's the frustrating thing, is because I'm here and I'm always telling her what to do and what not to do, and she's stopped listening to me. And then when she has a moment, she realizes, she gets stuck on apologizing to me, and that gets frustrating as well. It's just the whole situation. But
This is your test. This is your test of life. We all have our own test, and you've got to work through it. Okay.
Yeah. I'm getting there.
You can do it. All right.
Thank you. Okay, we'll get on to, I have a word. I don't know if it is anything, but I noticed it and it got stuck in my head. You know how, I think it's Mexicans They say olé. They go olé, olé, olé. Is it the Mexicans that say that?
Well, it may also
No,
be
like
it may be Italian also,
it.
but anyway, we
Okay.
know it. Yeah, it means
Yeah,
truly the
olé.
symbolism. You're spilling the beans on the symbolism. What?
I got thinking of olé. Because it's, yeah.
Right. Ole and ole,
Yeah.
but the O by itself, because it only has one O.
Yeah, I wrote that down separate from lay as well. Yeah.
Right. So the O means true, perfect, and complete, and so it's like two words. The O is a symbol, and you know how in some scriptures and other books they have the O all by itself, like oh. You know, and then they
Yeah.
got the sentence, right? But what is that O all by itself? Nobody defines it. And the O
Yeah.
is a completion of cycle. It has no beginning, has no end. So it's a symbol of infinity. It's the symbol of the Ouroboros, the serpent eating its tail, the sun going around. But of course, it's not the sun going around. It's the earth spinning round and round. And that serpent is continually going around eating its tail. And meaning, you know, it's starting all over again every day. And so literally in the primary sense, it means true, perfect, and complete. That's what the O represents as a symbol, not to mention the sun and the moon and possibly the earth, depending upon the pretext of use. But then so and lei is a prime word for light. And so when you go to Hawaii, what they do, they put the flowers
Yeah, I was
around you,
thinking
and
of that.
it's the lei, and that's
Yep.
the budhe. The budhe is the flower, the bud that opens up. The flower is the sun. The flowers represent the sun. They represent the light that comes forth, and isn't it sweet? The scent that we find, the bees go in and get the pollen and make us that honey from the sweetness of the symbol of the sun. You see, there's nothing sweeter than knowing the truth that everything began with the light, and the Father is light, and in him is no darkness at all, as the Shultres say. And so literally, lei meaning light, then so therefore, ole, ole is an expression that is like you could then hear him now jumping up and saying,
Wow.
literally, the true and the perfect light.
Yes.
You see? Yeah, it's an expression of a that means something, but ole,
Yeah.
we don't get the meaning, of course, at all by its nature.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. So I wrote it down right, the first time. I've got the O separate, and then I've got lay, and then underneath I've got ooh lay.
Okay.
Yeah, so I wrote it down right. Yeah. Wow. Thank you, Desert.
Okay. And so if you've got two O's, then it's ule, and then it's the
Yeah.
vision of light, the vision of
That's what I
light.
was thinking. I was thinking, ooh, as in owl. Yeah.
Ule.
Yeah.
Okay.
Wow. Wow. Ooh. And then the AY. Yeah. Oh, Desert. Wow. Sorry. A bit delayed there.
Right. And the AY, as we talked about, meaning the
Yeah.
light, the AY is the prime root for the word I.
Yep.
That's the original word for I, EYE. I'll put it in the chat. EYE is AY. And the I is what, Ninja?
The I is
Is
what?
in
Sorry,
nature. It is in
wowie.
the
Say it
sun.
again. Can you say
The
it?
sun. The I
The
is the
I is the
sun.
sun.
Even
Yeah.
the occult put that on the dollar bill, right? The pyramid at the top of the pyramid, it's the sun, and
Yeah.
they put an I in there. They're telling us, but they don't regard the light. They don't regard the sun. It's all smoke and mirrors, you know, because they're mother sons of darkness. That's what Masonic means, mother sons of darkness, you know. And so, but they claim the light. That's Lucy. She's looking pretty good in her dress and her and you know, and all done up. But yet she is a you know, a blind goddess. The blindfold on her, as we see in front of the courthouse, is telling us that she has no real light because she can't see, right? So she has no real light. She can't see. She's got a blindfold on, holding the balances in her hand. And there's Shelley throwing up some code at us. Okay, the all-seeing eye of the sun, right? Okay, and so
Wow. Okay. I'm just sorry if you can hear background noise. I'm just looking for something. Oh, where is it? Where is it? Where is it? I've got your dictionary printed out and it's in two sections and I can't find the other half at the moment. Oh, where's it gone? Where's it gone? Where's it gone? Anyway, I wanted to have the dictionary in front of me while I was talking about this, and I don't know what I've done with it. No, I'm holding up your live stream looking for it while on the
phone.
Yeah,
you got to be prepared when you come on here now, Ninja. Come on.
Yeah, I know.
All right, that's right.
Anyway, in your dictionary, right? I hope you remember this. Otherwise, we'll do it on the Chronicles. You have Sophia in there, mm-hmm. the name Sophia.
Right.
And from what I remember, I don't want to get it wrong. Oh, hang on. Here we go. Found it. I'll just get it in front of me so that I can be correct in what I'm saying. I'm just looking for S.
Oh, and if you're looking, I'm just going to define it. I just posted it on the chat. And Shul is knowledge in the prime element of there's the serpent and the breath. The SH is the serpent and the breath. And the OOL is the owl that sees. So there's the symbol for knowledge. Knowledge of the breath, knowledge
yes.
of the serpent.
I was going to say intelligence.
And so the Fae, Shul Fae. So in Sophia, we can see Shul Fae and then Yah, Shul Fae Yah.
Yeah.
There's how it goes back to ain't the primitive. You see, Sophia is a modern creation, an abbreviation of an original thought. And so it's Shul Fae Yah. And so Shul Fae Yah then means the knowledge of the woman's creation. That goes round. There's more. I could say the eye of creation because of the AY, but PH is the prime element of creation. So so I'll type it in there. The knowledge.
Okay. It says here.
Hold on. Okay. The knowledge of the creation that goes round. Go ahead.
Yeah, pretty close. The great key knowledge of the virgin woman that goes round.
Is that what you wrote down?
That's what you wrote down in your dictionary.
Oh, in the dictionary. See, yeah. So it's a variable.
Because
at times it can go in three or four different ways of saying it in different directions based upon the primitive root forms. Each primitive root form, each symbol is a word by itself, you see? And this is where how you can know if it's a positive or a negative. In the code, or if it's maybe a manipulation of the priesthood with all the false letters they gave us, the false symbols like the I, the J, the X, the W, the B, the C. I gave out seven letters that are all false creations of the priesthood so that we would be confused within our diction and could not follow the trail back to original thought. They hope we get stuck in the Greek and Hebrew, and they'll be real happy for it because they, as the old axiom goes, they don't care what the answers are as long as you're asking the wrong questions, you know. So if you ask the right questions, then you'll find out that why you're stuck in Hebrew and Greek, when it's demotic. They changed out the Greek alphabet. You can see it because on all the Greek monuments, they've got the capital letters that I typed right there on the knowledge of the creation that goes around. Those capital letters are found on Greek monuments. You can practically read the Greek monuments. You know, and the Roman monuments all have those capital letters, but then when we go to our Strong's biblical concordance, all of a sudden the Greek has transformed itself, wallo presto magico, into some squiggly little letters you'd never want to have to try to memorize. You know, and that's called demotic. That's what they did to the Aramaic. That's what they did to the Hebrew dialect, which still used Aramaic symbols when they came back from Babylon. And of course, the Sanskrit in India is really pseudo-Sanskrit because what I'm conveying right there is the original Sanskrit. Okay, let me just type it in there. This is the O-R-I-G-I-N-A-L, Sanskrit, S-C-R-I-P-T. Okay, it's Sanskrit. That's what it, not Sanskrit. You hear it's the sound, how they slant it. That's how they change all of our words, right? It's not Sanskrit, it's Sanskrit. And the only thing you can write in sand are those capital letters, straight lines and a circle. That's it, or an S, right? The serpent. That's what you draw in sand when you're a merchant on a ship meeting primitive cultures because these symbols were universal. And in fact, it's in, I can read that right here out of See if I can find it. It's in Psalms. Psalms. Bullinger was the one who pointed out so well. If I can find it here, 14 and the fool and how long? Oh, geez, that's. I'm not prepared either, Ninja. So don't worry about it. Okay, here it is. Wait a minute. Here it is. Hold on. Here it is. Psalm 19. The heavens, which means sun and moon, and then the declare the glory. Glory, another code word for the light. The sun, the stars, and the sun, earth, the star, the sun and the moon and the stars declare the illumination, the enlightenment of Yahweh, who is the great Elohim. It says, glory of God. But there's your code. All of it's a code. It's all taken over. They took over the original words. So I'm transliterating as I read here. So the sun, moon, and the stars declare the illumination of Yahweh, who is the great Elohim, and the sky, that's firmament. The sky reveals his handiwork, and day after day, it utters speech. What utters speech? Well, the pictures. Get the picture, right? The sun is a logo. The sun is a symbol of the great spirit, and the stars are up there, pictures, Orion, the pyramid. Orion's pointing his bow to the pyramid. They call it a bull, but look at it. It's a pyramid, you see? You can clearly see the pyramid, the three stars creating the pyramid. And so day and night utter speech with the symbols of nature and of up in the sky, and night after night shows his knowledge, night after night, yeah. The nighttime, because it's the pictures in the sky, and these our alphabet was drawn from these pictures, as well as from nature. There is no speech nor tongue. It says here language. No speech nor language. That's a corruption, but that's all right. No speech nor language where this voice is not heard. There is nowhere that this voice is not heard. And the good news, this message. That's the good news. This message of the star enlightenment has gone out throughout all the earth and these Eshavors, the words, to the ends of the earth. And he has set his tabernacle where? In the throne of the sun. He set up his tabernacle in the sun among the stars. So that's the mother star, you see? And he is a bridegroom coming out of his chamber. What chamber? We just said it. From the sun. And stands up in the flowing light as a strong man to run the races of mankind. There you go. You just got the transliteration of the corruption that we find in our scriptures. That was Psalm 19 through verse 5, okay? And he's going forth, continued 6, going forth from the end of the sky unto the circuits of the ends thereof, and there is nothing hid from the center of his breath. What is the center of his breath? The sun, because he breathed into it, and it was ignited. And the same breath that breathed into the sun is the breath that wants to breathe into us. Oh, and down here in verse 7, continuing, the law of Yahweh is perfect. I know that mainstream Christians hate that one. His law is perfect because they say nobody's perfect or can follow perfectly. We could almost say that appears that way, but that's still not true. Converting the soul. Convert the law of the, and we're going to read about in just a little bit here. What more do we have to do at the end of the world than to talk about all this stuff? So I'm not going to be in a hurry today, but we're going to get there. So hang on. And converting the soul, and the testimony. Testimony is the declaration, more properly, the declaration of the Yahweh is trustworthy, making wise the young Eshan. Okay, and so I won't go any further. That was through verse 7. And so we see how it's been glossed over and smashed so that we could never really get the picture with these code words. And that's why we have to decode it while we're reading it here so people can get the actual picture, Ninja. And, of course, I don't know anything, but you please continue.
Okay, thank you. That was beautiful. If I forget, just keep in mind Sophia because we need to go back to that. Underneath Sophia in your dictionary, you know how we're always joking around saying don't apologize? Underneath Sophia is sorry, and it says the royal serpent, eye of light, for sorry. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the sore eye. You see in the word sorry, what do you see in the word sorry? The sore eye, right? What happens when you're sorry? You're crying, right?
Wow.
And so S-O-R-R-Y is the Zor, it'd be Zor, Z-O-R, as we say Zorain, right? And it's the Zor, E-Y-E, the Zor eye, the sore eye, the sore, S-O, how do you spell sore? S-O-R-E,
yeah.
Sore, I-E-Y-E, okay? So you see the play on the words, right? It's so yeah. There's your original thought. You see, it was right there all along, but we never got the picture. And now we get the picture that what happens when you stare at the sun? You're crying because you got the sore eye. You're sorry. You're looking up at the light saying, please forgive me. You know, the sore eye. Okay. Yeah.
Wow.
Azor, remember, Azor is the sun in the Indo-Germanic, and Zorain is the light coming down from the sun. So the Zor is the prime. You know, prime element, and then we got the Z with Zorro. Zorro's making the Z in the mythology, right? Because the Z represents the light, lightning coming down. The Zor. You know, and so yeah, it's all in the Asia Voris, but nobody can interpret because we've never been taught this stuff in school. Therefore, nobody knows how to read, and we're getting here an Indo-Germanic 101 for the first time in our lives, right here on this broadcast. You know, because somebody has to. You know, we have a crack in the wall. We're going through the wall. A crack, we see a crack. There's light there. Look, let's go through it. All right. You know, because we've been lied to all of our lives, but there's always a crack in the wall somewhere. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Can I tell you my connection now?
Sure.
With, I've been hinting at it.
Wait a minute. You have connections? Never mind. Go ahead. She's got connections. Okay. Let's hear about it. I got connections too, by the way. I just want you to know.
Sorry.
It's all right. You can joke around.
Sorry,
you know, we're allowed
I don't
to do that.
I have a sore eye. I'm not sorry. No. Okay. Sorry, you can blame Yojaneer for that last outburst.
All right.
Okay. I will not be clipping this part for the cosmic essence.
You better. You can't leave nothing out. Go ahead. Please continue. I want to hear about your connections now. Come on.
Okay. So I'm sorry. Sophia. Okay, I've been hinting at this, but haven't really known how to explain it. If I don't do it properly now, I will prepare for the Chronicles properly. Mm-hmm. A few years back, I did a lot of research on what they're doing, like when I was looking into all the weird stuff like the cloning and the artificial intelligence and all that sort of stuff, right? Okay, just before I get into that, we'll go to the present day. You were saying how the numbers are always off with YouTube at the moment, like more extreme. At the moment, when I made that last video on my channel, Just Breathe, that song, when I was looking around, I came across a channel that had music on it, and I looked at the about page because I check everything out to make sure I'm not copywriting anything. I looked at the about page and a human was not controlling that channel. That channel had been generated by the YouTube algorithm, like an entire channel created by a non-human. Yeah.
Okay.
AI. And that got me thinking about Sophia again, because I've gone back and forth with this. Sophia is a really creepy looking example of artificial intelligence that looks human. And
Yeah, that's the one we've been seeing a picture of for the past year or so.
Yeah,
right. Always at a conference somewhere talking and joking, right?
Yeah, even joking on a talk about show. Controlling the world and all that sort of thing.
Yeah.
I see a connection between that because their technology, the controllers that control this world, it's the basis of everything. Like the targeting, the mind control, it's all, this world is all their technology. Trying to explain. And when I was researching Sophia, they were talking about all sorts of things. Now I'm having a blank. Putting consciousness into the Sophia robot. There was even YouTube videos and whatever saying, is Sophia going to accommodate the quote unquote Antichrist and all that sort of thing. And so I think that's valid. And seeing Sophia in your dictionary saying the great key knowledge of the virgin woman that goes around, that's the connection I saw. I think somehow they're going to use this, like they're going to use Sophia for something. And there's so many distractions and diversions going on in this world at the moment that the focus has gone away from all the artificial intelligence and robots and all that sort of thing. And it's their technology, and what they're showing us isn't anywhere near as advanced as what they actually have. Like, we know that.
Mm-hmm.
And I also think the YouTube thing with all the wackiness and shenanigans going on there is another distraction away from that. And Do you see the connection that I'm trying to explain?
Sure. They're playing on another name for the woman, Columbia.
Yeah.
In other words, the Columbia is a definite code for the two columns, but Sophia, being that their Columbia is represented as a woman, then the wisdom of the woman is represented as Sophia. So Columbia is the two columns. Sophia is wisdom, and so Shul. It's a primitive combination of abbreviated terms that, as you see, we expand into three obvious words, which is still can be expanded into more words, you know.
Yeah.
And that's right. The woman, woman is regarded as wisdom because why? Because all of nature is speaking the wisdom of the Father. The mother is speaking for the Father, right? She is the one on the scene, while the spirit is behind everything, the Father's spirit. So the mother is in the front here, and this is why the woman is portrayed by the occultic. They hate the Father. They love the woman. They love it down here. They don't want to go back to the pure energy because they can't, because they'd have to be good, and they don't want to be good. You know, so they're going to have a party instead. They're going to have a train wreck and won't try to kill as many people as they can in the process, you know, because that's the way they are. You know, what can we say?
And what you're saying about how with the woman and nature and all that sort of thing, there's a duality there, how they've created an artificial robot, called it Sophia, and they're saying they're going to put consciousness in it, which is probably
They want to talk about taking our memory, our consciousness, and putting it in some other machine, saying then we can live forever. Give me a break.
Exactly.
Get people excited. You know,
Thank you.
So forget that light that's shining up there. Forget what that means. You know, the light coming down.
Thank you. I just wanted to get all of this out of my head and into the air, into YouTube land. So thank you.
YouTube land.
Thank you for helping.
All right.
Yeah. Couldn't have done it without you.
YouTube land is sort of like Disneyland, right? I mean, a bunch of crazies out there having it going around in circles.
Oh, what a world. Yeah.
World means spin. World means spin, by the way. I was just going to say,
I had the word.
And lantern means the lantern.
I had world going around my head, spinning around my head. The word world today.
Getting too excited. Sorry. You're going to have to settle down now. Cut it out.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Right. Yeah.
What else?
Just yeah.
Are we good, or do we do enough damage, or do we need to go further? Anything else?
No.
You're reading the Book of Jasher. You're enjoying Jasher, and you're going to bring it up on the next interviews.
I'm going to do it on the Chronicles because I need to highlight. I've got my yellow highlighter right in front of me.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll bring it up on Chronicles.
Yeah,
I will.
And Shelley, you may want to just post the Book of Jasher real quick for our friends. So if they hadn't seen it yet, or they want to get a copy, the story behind the story on everything from Ganesha, Genesis, all the way through Judges. This is the scoop. 100 chapters, just under 100 chapters of the story behind the story of everything. You know, every character in there, it's going to blow your mind if you've not read Jasher. I've read it. I used to buy 10 copies at a time and give it away to, you know, people at work and everything. I was so excited about sharing it 40 years ago. And it's the best kept secret on earth. And it's mentioned twice in our scriptures. It's, you know, validated there. It is referred in Joshua and 2 Samuel. Okay. So, yeah, go check it out, ladies and gentlemen. And we're going to talk about it on NinjaCat 111 on Monday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, and also on Fridays, every Fridays at 10 a.m. Eastern Time. Okay, so, Ninja, so please continue, unless we're through.
I was just thinking, do you want to do a little bit of reading from it? Like, I'd love to be able to at least transliterate little bits and pieces myself,
you pick out what interests you, and then you can read it, and then I'll be glad to transliterate it on the broadcast. Okay, we can do that. Because we want to give people the flavor of transliteration. Yeah. You know, we're hoping that they're going to get the original terms, so they realize that these things create pictures in our mind. And then they bring us back to ground zero, center point.
Yeah.
Not in the outer circle, in the outer limits, the twilight zone, but back to zero point. That's where we got to get. And it comes through the Ace of Horus. In the beginning is the what? Not. It said was. It said what? They want us to think it's past tense, right? In the beginning is the word, is the Ace of Horus. That's the royal eye at the center. What is the royal eye at the center? It is the ability to communicate, to see, and get the picture. You know, it starts with pictures. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Sorry, I was just agreeing with you, saying, I really want to do that. I should have asked a long time ago, but I was thinking since I do have the honor of having a live stream with you, and you just said what I was going to say. The Ace of Wands are alive. They speak. And doing that will be so powerful. Wow.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
So we'll do
Thank
it.
You.
Okay. And then we'll go into our other normal read. And we can open with that if you want to. I'll be happy to. That's why we got you the book, you know.
Yeah.
So you can see and read it for yourself and draw from it. It's a great conversation piece, you know. Okay, so are we good? Is there anything else?
No, I think we're good.
All right. Well, great.
We covered a lot. Does it? So, I think.
Was it like 3:30 in the morning over there?
I think that's
Morgan?
Why I'm kind of stopping mid-sentence. It's 3:25. Yeah.
Ninja really sacrifices to be with us, ladies and gentlemen. So do check out her YouTube channel, NinjaCat 111, and know that if you want to support her relocation program, you can make a nice donation through her PayPal. It's on her descriptions. Okay, so just check it out and thank you. Okay, so Ninja, very good. Always great to have you. All right.
I'm gonna lay down after this, but I've had a lot of coffee, so I'll probably stay awake through the whole stream. But just so you know, if I disappear from the chat, I've fallen asleep.
Okay, well, good enough. We'll see you in the chat then.
Okay, thank
okay,
you.
Thank you.
Peace and light to you always, always. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Okay, I have to hang up. Yeah, sorry,
okay.
I nearly forgot.
And we're going to go to our first musical break. Okay, we're going to do that. All right. So we're going to drop you off, Ninja, and thank you. Peace and love. And I already know I've got to mute out here. Okay, I got to mute out.
Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order.
The new world order does not mean surrendering our national sovereignty or forfeiting our interests.
Your eyes are blind. of water in an endless sea. All we do crumbles to the ground, though we refuse to see.
Dust in the wind.
All we are is dust in the wind.
Everything is dust in the wind, ladies and gentlemen. Stardust, absolutely. And welcome back to Forbidden History Live. I'm your host, Desert Owl. Glad you're tuned in. Want to welcome any new listeners out there. And we always have people coming through. And do promote if you don't mind. If you value this presentation, the product. That's what a term that we could use for this presentation is it's a product that. People can take advantage of a production, and so Crystal, you're saying you can use the genie I sent you, Desert. It's for okay, thank you. And so, but we're trying to define things, and that's all we're supposed to do. My one classic quote that I wrote once I was laying on a concrete slab, looking up at a concrete ceiling surrounded by concrete walls and cold steel and cold hands and cold hearts was once we can begin to comprehend the true nature of things, then we can begin to comprehend that there is nothing more to complain about. Okay, once we know the nature of things, and the beauty is once you know the spiritual paradigm of being in the one who made all things in the in our universe, when you're in his connected with him, then you know that the nature of things has suddenly changed and that you are engaged with what is supernatural, super nature, because nature is for the people, the common people, just sort of like, you know, going fishing and, you know, enjoying the woods and smelling the pine trees, but they never get the picture of the supernatural that is behind it all, that it unfolds, it is in flux, there are two worlds right here and now, okay, and that's the sovereignty that protects you. The sovereignty is within the light of Yeshua, okay, not outside the light. That all of that sovereignty is a phony sovereignty, just like the secret handshake club. They call themselves super sovereigns, you know, because they got the handshake and the secret grand hailing sign and the middle finger and everything else. You know, they think they're sovereigns. Well, guess what? They can't keep their soul alive. No, they're going back to the dirt that they came from. But we can transcend as spirits. Their spirits are bound here in chains forever. That's what the scriptures say. Of course, they corrupted the transliteration, but you know, you've heard it before, but you had a different picture. But they are bound. The ancient Aryan watchers are bound here in chains forever. They cannot go back. And so since they're not going back, they don't want you to go back, babe. No, they want you earthbound as well. And that's why they took over spirituality and religion, because they got to control the chessboard, you know? So it's quite a deal. And our job is to unravel the great mystery and to be set free and not buying their pablum and the next propaganda piece they put out there on YouTube or on television, you know, that everybody sucks up into, the next great idea, the great fad. You know, because nobody can define how this universe operates. That's rather interesting, you know, in that sense, you know. And they really, really like us. Yeah, they love us to death. Just love, right? They love us to death. They're here to keep us dead and not let us breathe and live. So, and they destroyed all of our trees, all of the plankton in the ocean now, and all of our oxygen is being used up, and methane gas is floating up into the atmosphere, and our world's about to burn up. You know, so that's the narrative of what they gave to us. That's how much they love. You know, when they wanted to beat you up with their little socialist bureaucrats in the government, you know, they wanted to knock on your door. Oh, by the way, you know, you can't build, you know, can't put that dirt over there in that swamp area because a tsetse fly is over there, or the warded frog, you know, and so we're going to fine you $10,000 for messing with the frog's habitat. But what, at the same time, they destroyed the entire planet. And killed all the whales, all the dolphins, all the coral reefs, and you know, and all of us. You know, what a show they put on! What hypocrites and great pretenders! The communists, of course, they're communist, socialist, Nazis, all rolled into one. You know, because it's one version is just another version of the other version, just another name, another title, but the same players on the chessboard always, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, and that's where they got us. That's where they got a bed for us. You see, right there. And they're happy to bond our hide and put us on Wall Street if you know, we can let them get away with it. You know, are the archons of the Demiurge still a problem? Well, yeah, but I don't use the word archon. Now, that typically comes out of the Nag-Hammadi, and we talked about that. I remember Tiddly, but let me just type in here something, okay? And you'll see it really clearly because I know I'm going to show you right now who the archons are, okay? Okay, so here it is. Okay, A-R. I got to get the capital letters going. Hang on. Okay, A-R. And then we're going to get to T-Love's follow-up for her, okay? A-R. How did you spell that? A-R-C-H with the C-H. C-H-O-N-S. Okay, and then here it is. Because R, as you can see, with R, it means power. N-O-W-E-R. Of O-F, the con. Okay, so who has the power of the con? Is it not the con artists, you know, the archons, the power? You see, so this is how, just like when they created the word devil and Satan, you know, and Lucifer, all these words mean something else. And it always points back to them, right? The serpent points to all of us. Then they got rid of the word serpent and called it Satan. It's funny that the same temptation that Adam and Eve went through, Yeshua went through in the wilderness. They were all tempted, but yet they got a serpent in the old covenant. They got a Satan in the new covenant. Wait a minute, isn't it the same thing that tempts us all? Isn't it the flesh, right? Isn't it the dense matter, our dense brains, brain matter that, you know, has confused our minds? And so the archons, who are the archons? They are the people who put their pants on just like everybody else. They're the cons. They're the power of the con. Who has the power of the con? The ones who have been given free reign and free will on the planet, you see? And so there's your archons. And this is how they control these translations. Just like I said, the word heaven is, you know, is a code for the evening. Oh, so what we think of as heaven is really the darkness. Oh, my. I thought heaven was the light. Unless heaven is a code and we break it, and we find out that it either means the cosmos or the sun or the sky, depending upon the pretext, not the context. We don't want a context. You know, just like when you look up in, you know, Webster's 1828 First American Dictionary, and you look under gregation, it says a gathering of religious people. Well, what do we call it today? A gregation is called a congregation. Oh, that's right. They put the con on us, didn't they? Yeah. Means to create. Well, they're creators. That's what the Freemasons brag about, right? That they are the creators and the destroyers. They are the Shiva Lingam, right? Doing the dance On the baby, right? Yeah. Okay. So, what do you say? I'm sorry, I didn't get the question that way. Anyway, so let's get, and I'll keep looking over there, but let me get on with T-Love. May have to actually go somewhere, and I've been telling her I'm going to do a follow-up here. So let's see, where do I got 4 3x5 cards here, and I've got to see how I want to flow with this. So, so two deities. We talked about the two deities, Just Love and the duality, okay? And so look at the duality. You know, there were two, and then we're going to, by the way, after this, we go to the Gospel of the Essenes, okay? And that read, because like everybody's been on this cliffhanger since last program, and we're coming up, okay? So we're about to get there. And this is beautiful, because what your questioning was about flows right into the other story of the Ten Commandments that you never heard before. It's a short read out of the Gospel of the Essenes, and then we're going to go into the Gospel of the Perfect Life and to the Transfiguration on the Mountain with Yeshua and get some parallels and comparisons here, because there's a duality, okay? And so the two deities, because you were talking about, okay, you know, how come the Old Covenant deity demanded blood and sacrifice, and, you know, and all that, you know, what's going on with all that? When, you know, Yeshua comes along and introduces us to the Father, and all of a sudden we're told not to, you know, seek retribution or eye for eye and tooth for a tooth, but to forgive, love our enemies, you know, and all of that, right? Recycle, renew. That's a good one, right? And so, so the two deities. So there's two laws, okay? And so here's the two aspects of, you know, because it's telling a story about creation. And so in the lower world, we have what's called the chaotic. So the beginning of creation started with fire and explosions and you know, and think of how the earth came to be, right? It was all fiery, and then the, you know, the chaotic, the water, and then finally, you know, these creatures, these primitive creatures that were here first, you know, what we call the dinosaurs. Of course, you know, the narrow thinking Christians can't wrap their mind around the age of the earth. They can't even see with their own eyes. They got to close their eyes real hard to the age of the earth, that it's millions of years old. Billions, actually. Try about 4 billion approximate. Science is telling us the truth on that. And that the chaotic came first, the great monsters, right? That's what I was talking about with the bull. There's a monster in our modern time. You don't ever want to get in the ring with a bull. You're dead, right? You know, and so the first world is chaotic. And so the old world that we're talking about, that you're talking about, where the blood was demanded and sacrificed and everybody's killing each other, and apparently it was okay for Israel to go around with the sword and kill the other nations and even kill the women and children and all the animals, right? That's what Yahweh told them to do, right? Although it's through the agent, and it was through the antithesis to the thesis, because it was the those who are serving the blind goddess, as we talk about the blind goddess, that is acting on behalf of Yahweh as the agent, the Elohim. In the singular, they were serving the woman, and she was called Elahe. Elahe is the singular feminine aspect of a goddess, not a god, but a goddess, in our modern terminology, but it is correctly Ulohim, or in the corruption, Elohim. Okay, so that's the lower creation, and that's why it's represented as a woman, because the woman is smaller than the man. The man is represented by spirit, and woman is the representative of matter, and she's bringing forth the baby. And the baby's not coming till the end. Okay, that's when the baby's coming. So in the meantime, the woman's pregnant, but she's got a lot of labor going on inside of her, you know, the pain and the struggle, right? You know, see, so even the woman in the aspect of having a baby goes through the chaotic as well, right? She'd like to say, hey, can we just get over all this drama and just have the baby? No, you got to go through the pain and suffering. And so that's, again, symbolic as well. Just Love, you're saying, so you're saying these gods or horses are reincarnate as humans, gods or horses? No. No, I don't know where the horses came from. Unless you're talking about, are you, goddesses, right. Okay, so let me just stay focused. You all have to listen to the replay. Autocorrect, sorry. Okay, autocorrect. I don't have that on mine. All right, so let's get back to it. All right, so animal world, chaotic. The chaotic is represented by the animal world, actually. That's my note right here, okay? The chaotic world, so there's a lower creation, right? But we're really not a part of the lower creation. But what happened to man when he fell is he started acting like animals, right? So he started acting like, and this is the lower garden. It's not the upper garden, it's the lower garden. You see, so there's two worlds. And so we have to identify that we're not a part of the lower world and we're a part of the higher world. So the lower world is chaotic, it's the animal world, and it's the whore, okay? And it demands blood, right? That's all we see is bloodletting everywhere we go. Animals, what do animals do? They eat each other, right? They have a sacrifice on each other. It's death, life-consuming death, life-consuming death, life-consuming death. It's the chaotic. It's not natural in the sense of what the divine love was wanting to talk about, right? That he wanted to introduce us to, but we had to come through the chaotic mix of this alchemical development, this transformation from one state to another. We had to have the lower state because we have free choice. We choose if we want to go to the higher state. It's all up to you. There's no guarantees. You have to be the guarantor in your own life. He made you the judge. The great judge isn't going to judge you. You're already condemned. He's going to let you be your own judge, and you decide where you get to go. That's the great mystery that he did. So the higher world is the placid. It's the peaceful, not the chaotic, but the placid, the beautiful, like the island paradise, right? The garden, the pure garden. And so that's the higher world, and that's the represented as the virgin, you see? So the virgin represents the higher creation of purity, of honesty, of light. And then the lower creation is the whore, the chaotic. She demands blood. And so what happens in the virgin? He gives his own blood. The one who made the cosmos, the first made Yeshua as the first atom, A-T-O-M. Then in the end, at the end of all this chaotic, comes to introduce us to the true nature of what was actually before the firstborn. That which was truly first came last. But people in the old world could not receive it. So it's introduced last 2,000 years ago at the end of time, as it says in Hebrews clearly. And he gave his own blood. So he was willing to give himself as a sacrifice. So no other sacrifices were ever needed, but it was symbolic, like when Abraham was going to sacrifice Ishaq, Zabraham sacrificing Ishaq, but it was a symbol of that at the end of time, one would come to give his own life. So the lower nature was used as a supplement to human sacrifice. But we see in the occultic, because they love killing people, they were happy to sacrifice their babies and women, right? The Mayans used to throw women into the pit, into the water, in the deep holes over there, you know? And so basically, that which comes second, okay, as we talk about the second born, is what actually represents what was in the beginning before the chaotic came to be, you see? So in the middle zone that we could call the wilderness or the wasteland is that chaotic. Because what was instituted before he said, let there be, you know, it was already designed. And the peace that is being offered to us as a second born takes us back to that which was actually first. And that was before creation, chaotic, came to be. Creation is pretty chaotic, isn't it? I mean, we're in the grave of our body. Our body is another aspect of hell. Hell meaning the grave. Hades meaning the grave. Sheol meaning the grave. Okay, but they want us to think it's some place of eternal fire. And Texas, good to have you. And welcome to the broadcast. Any of our new listeners out there as well, you're tuned into Forbidden History Live, what they didn't want you to know, but we tell right here. And I'm your host, Desert Owl. And hope you will tell your friends about the broadcast. And we can have a revolution in thinking, okay? Because we have to hear things we've not heard before. And so the bull then represents the monster, right? But here's how the bull would really be spelled, okay? Because the bull represents the moon. It has a, because the bull has two horns, it actually can represent the sun or the moon, you know, but because it's implying two powers. And so it has a double nature in itself, right? It, and so the bull, but bull, as we see, I'm going to type it in here, B-U-L-L, is, and we see as B-A-A-L would be actually more correct, like B-A-A-L-L, ball, because the there's two A's, and so the two A's represent two powers. And so you got the yin-yang, you see, and the L, two L's are the two columns that the Masons want to represent in their occultic tradition, as this one representing the sun, one representing the moon. And so in the aspect of the two A's in Baal, you don't say Ba'al, you don't say Ba'al, you say Baal, you pronounce one A, but you've got two symbols. And so one is a vowel and one is a consonant. And the and the one that is silent represents Yahweh. That is the, and the one that is speaking is the Hor. The one that is speaking is the occultic tradition, you see? And so in the Baal tradition, they thought they were serving the great God, you know, to use their terminology, the great Yahweh, but yet because it's run by corrupt priests and it's not a pure tradition, it has corrupted elements within it. And so you said, what about the bull of heaven, Ishtar? Well, Ishtar means like in what we call Mesar, Egypt, the power of Isis. The power of Isis, or the power of the royal eye, the woman again, Aisha. Okay, it's just another version of the other version. So the bull of heaven, meaning the bull of the sky. You know, I don't know what scripture or mythos you're. Orion is pointing to the bull. They call it a bull, but it's really the pyramid. Okay, and so what did they do? They fed their bull all around the world. They created pyramid civilizations all around the world. Go to work, slave. Start cutting stone. Start lifting stone. Come on. You're working for us now. You know, there's us up there, Orion, the Aryan, now telling you what to do. The blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white-skinned superior who got the knowledge from, you know, Adam, and they decided to conquer the world and enslave everyone, the fallen Vakaresh, the watchers, you know. So it's just... you know, it's all going back to the same story, you know, and so I hope that, you know, helped you out a little bit. You may have to get on the phone to do a follow-up. And then I have one more here. Why was sacrifice instituted? Again, I've got the note here. Why was the sacrifice instituted? Because creation itself, here it is, okay, because creation itself is a sacrifice. That's what it's telling us, right? In other words, when he said, let there be a creation, well, what do you think? Do you think he meant for this universe to be here forever? Remember the old axiom? That which has a beginning has an end. Now the Father of Light, Yahweh, he has no beginning, has no end. I can't even wrap my mind around that one, you know? That's a mind blower. But the point is that which has a beginning, it's not hard to wrap our mind around the fact that which has a beginning has an end. And so what is instituted, like the sun itself, one day... you know, will no longer be shining. I don't know when, I don't know how, you know, or, you know, may have another 100 billion years left in it. I don't know. But the point is, as the laws of nature tell us, that which has a beginning has an end. And so in other words, remember the thing about the woman again, going back to the last week when Yeshua was hanging out at his buddy's house, Lazarus, Ulazar, correctly, and Mariam, the mother, the root, Yam, Maryam, not Maryim, but Maryam. Yam is root. So she's the virgin from the root of life, the sun. And when she's begrudged putting the oil on his feet, and Judas, the representing Judah, the tribe, the Judas, because Judah, the tribe of Judah, sold out the Messiah, the Moshiach. And he says, why did you put this oil on his feet? We could have sold it for 300 pennies. And he says, don't begrudge this woman. Okay, this thing that, and this is the correct translation, it's none of it's correct because they don't want us to get the picture, okay? This, because they love the woman, their woman, right? And so what did Yeshua actually say? This thing that the woman has done will be written about as a memorial for her. So we're being taught when he nails his body up on the tree, the serpent, nails the worthless serpent up on the tree. He has the victory of light and says it's finished. Now creation has gone full cycle, and now he has instituted the perfection of man on a wholesale level for anybody who would want to flow into his royal house. The perfection of man. And so the woman represents creation, and so she was a temporary house for temporary use. Mother is matter. Motor is matter. Matrix is matter. The mother is creation. So creation itself is being sacrificed on the cosmic altar. So that's what these sacrifices on the microcosm represent in the might and the macrocosm. Okay. So I hope I was able to get that out. And I have one more note here. That which has a beginning has an end, you know? So lower nature is being used. In other words, even Yeshua, you know, didn't like the sacrifices. When we read this story in the Aquarian Gospel, which is the original gospel, it is the bedrock of all the gospels, and his entire life story, they all say, we don't know where he was for the first 12 years. Oh, really? After he was 12, from 12 to 30. We don't know where he was for 17, 18 years. Yeah, I guess they never read the Aquarian Gospel then. But we find out that Yeshua hated the blood sacrifices, okay? He said, when he was talking to Hillel, I think it was Hillel the First, or maybe Hillel the Second, and he goes into the temple and asks him, why are we having these blood sacrifices? How can we claim to be a people in love, of love? And yet then we slaughter. Can't you smell the stench of those sacrifices out there? You see, it was never intended for man to, and so in other words, they think it's a glory, you know, because they're going to the temple, they're feeling like holy men, bringing their lamb, they're going to sacrifice their lamb. When what was better, the sacrifice of the heart to do the right thing, or to continue to close your eyes and then need to go do a sacrifice because you closed your eyes and you engaged in doing things that you were not supposed to be doing? Now the only way to get cleansing from it is to kill an animal. You see, so the objective was, we don't glory in sacrifices, we glory in having a perfect heart. Oh, there's that dirty word again, having a perfect heart, you know. Okay, and so you can Google Ishtar, bull of heaven, for the story. Okay, I wonder if they worship the bull for that reason. These were those, they worship the bull. That's why they made a bull, not a calf, but a bull, when Moses went up to the mountain, you know, and he's going to go get him the law. And they said, hey, we don't need Moses. We can make our own God. We got our own God, you know, so that's what they did. Okay, I can't get any more long-winded. I'm beginning to sense I'm losing my voice here, and I've got to get to the story. So we're going to do another break. Let's do a long one. Shelly, pick out a long song, okay? And if there's one we haven't heard before, that'd be great. I'd love to hear some of the other content for our friends to listen into. Moses had horns. No, that's in Michelangelo's statue. He gave him horns. It said that Quran came out of his head, meaning Quran, meaning projections. Okay, so it's up to the interpretation. But what it meant was his head shone. That's what it told us. His head was shining. When he came off, it was representing the sun, because our head is called the soul. And what is the soul but the sun? And so our power source, our mind, our head, it represents the sun. In other words, in the old ancient time, if you were smiling, they would have said to you, why is your sun shining? Look at her sun is shining. You see, because that was the metaphor for our brain. And hiding is with the brain is the symbol of the moon. Both the sun and moon are hiding within each other in an eclipse in our brain, in our head. But the sun is, so out of the head of Moses was the projections of light. He was beaming like the sun. Put up that beaming sun, Shelley, please. Can you put up that beaming sun? Okay, the yellow one we have all the time. Okay, because that's what they saw when he came off the mountain. A star was coming off the mountain. He was shining. He was beaming. And that's why even Adam was called the shining one, the bright one. Okay, because it wasn't, Lucifer, because Lucifer is merely an idea created by the occultic to hide the true narrative of the real Shining One, who had all the knowledge, who was up there in the throne of the sun, naming all things, while Yeshua made all things. This is the great narrative that has been hidden from us, okay? And so so there you go, ladies and gentlemen. And Just Love, I hope I helped you a little bit. We know the stories get misunderstood, misconstrued, so I'm just making connections. Right, well, that's what we're trying to do here is make connections. And that way I'm Aquarius here. Okay, crystals Aquarius, oh, very good. Sort of fits with crystals, right? Somehow, I don't know. But anyway, water is a crystal. Water is a crystal also. So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a long break. We may end up doing two songs because I really need to recharge, and we're going to just bring you a little entertainment, and it's fun. I enjoy listening to these songs myself. You know, I haven't listened to music in a long time because a lot of it, you know, is part of that mind control as well. But there's some good songs we can hear. And so, you know, when we get back, we're going to get into the Gospel of the Essenes and hear about the true story of the Ten Commandments, the part they didn't tell us on our scriptures because they took it out. They're always doing that. I wonder why. Yeah, these wicked priesthoods. Okay, so I'm Desert Owl. Glad you're tuned in. Still time to call a friend, okay? If you, after all, you want to know, right? So thanks for doing that, and we'll be right back. Don't go away.
The floor above. She sees a bartender in a pool of blood. Cries out, they killed my love. Here comes the story of the hurricane. The man the authorities came to blame for something that he never done. But in a prison cell, but one time he could have been the champion of the world. There's Patty C and another man, Arthur Dexter Bradley. I didn't do it, he says. He throws up his hands. I was only robbing the bodies. I hope you understand. I saw them leaving, he says, and he stops. One of us had better hurry and call the cops. And so Patty calls the cops. Couple of friends are driving around. Number one contender for the middleweight crown. Had no idea what kind of shit was about to go down. When a cop pulled him over to the side of the road, just like the time before and the time before that. In Patterson, that's just the way things go. If you're black, you might as well not show up on the street, 'cause you wanna drive. Rap on the cops. I just came in this place tonight to see what I could steal. Saw two men running out, they looked like middleweights. They jumped into a white car without a state plate. And Miss Patty Valentine just nodded her head. Cops said, wait a minute, boys, this one's not dead. So they took him to the infirmary. And though this man could hardly see, they told him he could identify the guilty. And take him upstairs. The wounded man lifts up to his one dying eye. He said, why'd you bring him in here for? He ain't the guy. Here's the story of the hurricane. The man the authorities came to blame for something that he never done. The ghetto's on its leg. Rumors in South America fight for his name. Well, Arthur Dexter Bradley still in the robbery game. And the cops are putting the screws to him, looking for someone to blame. Remember you murdered that you saw in a bar. Remember you said you saw the getaway car. Thinking like a playboy with the law. Thinking might have been that fighter that you saw running that night. Don't forget that you are white. I'm really not sure. Pop said a poor boy like you could use a break. We got you for that motel job. You get run out with Dello. Now you don't want to have to go back to jail. Be a nice fellow. You'll be doing society a favor. That son of a bitch is brave and getting braver. We want to put his ass in stir. We want to pin this triple murder on him. Here he goes, Jumping Jim. Take a man out with just one punch. But he never did like to talk about it all that much. It's my work, he said, and I do it for pay. And when it's over, just as soon go on my way. Up to some paradise. When the town seems slow and the air is nice. And ride a horse along the trail. But then they took him to the jail. Oh, where they tried to turn a man into a mouse. Cards were marked in advance. The trial was a pig circus. He never had a chance. The judge made Reuben's witnesses drunkards from the slums. To the white folks who watched, he was a revolutionary thumb. And to the black folks, he was just a crazy nigger. No one doubted that he'd pull the trigger. And no, they could not produce the gun. The DA said he was the one who did the deed. And the old white jury agreed. Carter was falsely tried. The crime was murder one. Guess who testified? Arthur Dexter Bradley and he boldly lied. And the newspapers, they all went along for the ride. How can the life of such a man be in the palm of some fool's hand? Does him obviously free. Couldn't help but make you feel ashamed. You live in a land where justice is a game. Free to drink martinis and watch the sunrise, while Reuben sits like Buddha in a 10-foot cell, an innocent man in a living hell. That's the story of the hurricane, but it won't be over till they clear his name and give him back the time he's done. Put in our prison cell, the one time he could have been the champion of the world.
And welcome back to Forbidden History Live, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm your host, Desert Owl. And we're making lemonade out of lemons. And I hope everybody's doing well out there. We have a lot of people in our world suffering, you know. And we're fortunate if everything's just going okay, right? It's amazing what we have to contend with in our world. And the great deception, you know, like, okay, Hurricane Carter, what a deal he got. He was ready to be the champion of the world in boxing. Not that the sport means anything to me, but, people were just trying to do their best on planet Earth the way they saw fit. And then, he's framed, you know, and even, as the story goes, the police know that he's not innocent, that he's not guilty. And in this is typical with the judges. That's why he's presiding, not presiding, but presiding, because it's about money. It's about money. And it may be that the guy that committed the crime was a Freemason and had a secret handshake and a grand hailing sign. Oh, one of our buddies. Okay. Yeah. Okay. We'll leave you alone, buddy, because you got the higher degree. Okay. We didn't know. He's just one of their agents, one of their players. And so the good old boy, you know, come on, Baba, I'm just doing my job, you know, okay. All right. Well, let's get Hurricane Carter then. Okay. And so, because they bonded his hide, Tidley a little while ago saying, why do we celebrate the birthday? Because the birth certificate is the surety. Oh, excuse me, it's the security, and you're the surety. You're the slave that's going to make it good. And when your body goes to prison, you're bonded on Wall Street, and they're making like 30. They always want to say it costs like 30,000 a month or a year or something to put people in prison. Nonsense. They make the funny money, about 30,000 a month, for all the local state, county, and federal governments and the prison institutions, especially on that telephone. Jeez, what a racket. What a racket. So he gets framed, and it was just by the grace of some Canadians. I saw the movie. Some Canadians, starting with a Canadian boy they adopted, was talking to Hurricane and found out his story, and the parents went to bat for Hurricane, and they even got Bob Dylan involved, and the publicity that came about, even Bob Dylan visited him in prison. So Hurricane lost his career, but he ultimately got his freedom, and that was the good news. And I love listening to that ballad. You know, it's a classic Bob Dylan song. The times they are changing, Jet. That song, when you listen to the words, he's admitting that he's given the mantra, the times they are changing, you know, and just listen to the words. Okay. Remember the code word is change. And so he's spilling it. And this is why, you know, just like, Higher Truth 2, the Higher Truth, what's his name? They took his channel down, you know, a plain truth too, you know, he did this, a presentation on this book this guy wrote, and it cost him his life, but he exposed that all the music comes out of one valley in California, you know, and even, Jerry Brown, the Jesuit, lived on, Wonderland Way, you know, in the valley. I mean, all of these people came out of this one little clique. And, so people like Bob Dylan, anyone big, or just like Led Zeppelin, you know, these very famous and very powerful, songs and musicians, like, in the song Stairway to Heaven. Well, and she's buying the Stairway to Heaven. Yeah, she bought the Stairway to Heaven. They tore the stairway down. There's no way back up to the sun, up to the light, right? And then they say also in the song, words have two meanings, you know, and then they give you the little backwards sound, Eisrope, and when you play it backwards, it means my sweet Satan, and, you know, all of their little tricks. So they're all puppies in the Illuminati families, you know, and so as much as I like Dylan, you know, I know, as he admitted when he was interviewed, he made a pact with the devil, and he was going to keep it, you know. So you got to read between the lines. You got to listen to their words and listen, you know, real good. And just like we could see how Michael Jackson, when we talked about him yesterday, he was coming out, you know, where others are happy to be in there. Jackson was coming out, so that's why he dies, you know. Not a player, not a good little boy, and so they'll take him down. He just wanted to be a real man. He wanted to be free, and he gets, his life defamed, his character defamed, and And that's what they, the way they do it to you, you know? And so it's very tragic, ladies and gentlemen, our world. And so we're going to, oh yeah, and I had one more follow-up with T-Love here as well, Just Love, because I don't remember, you know, the pretext that this was in. But bottom line, that's it. What was interesting is, you know, and it was Kip who said it on the other program on this interview, and he said the word was made flesh when we were in this discussion. And Kip, when he said the word was made flesh, and it was I can't remember the point that it was expressing, but then, you know, then when I realized then as the word is made flesh, because we are here today, we're gone tomorrow, but we're here for today, that not only is the word made flesh, but the word is the creation, the Eshavor, the royal eye. In other words, everything is at its own center, just like the spider web is at the spider is at the center of his web, right? You're at the center of your, you know, you are a royal center. And so the word itself, the sound vibration, the vav, the you know, the what we would call the va, but it's really, you know, the v. Oh geez, what did I just do? You gotta be careful here when I click. Without, okay, V, 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 okay? There's the sound wave, and the sound wave, the word, there's the Asha vortex, becomes the creation, okay? It starts with let there be a creation, and it comes forth. So Yeshua is the first atom, and so he constitutes all things because it started with the atom, and the whole mind, you know, of the creation was put within the atom itself. The atom, that which is great is like that which is least, and that which is the least is like that which is great. Up there is what was falsely called in the code Eden, and it's the atom, and it represents the very tiniest of all in creation. You see, that's that which is first is like that which is last. And what was in the beginning ultimately comes at the end, and it is the perfect creation. Yeah, Eden is the corruption. It starts with the A. The Eden is the atom, A-T-O-M, and it's the A. The A is the I. You know, that's where we're looking. It's the first of the alphabet. That's what Orion is pointing his bow to, the pyramid, the A. And the Om is the sound. You know, and the sound came forth. There's the sound wave. I just put it out. The A-T is the alphabet, the Aleph and the Tav, the beginning and the end. You see? It's all in the symbols. We have to know what the symbols mean. And what do you get in the atom backwards? You get, here it is. Put the royal R in there and you get motor, because the atom is the primary motor in creation and everything is spinning round, ladies and gentlemen. And Stephanie Allen, good to have you. And welcome to the broadcast. I think that may be your first time here. So there you go. Ladies and gentlemen, you have to know how the law works. You add the vowels, and the R is a secret vowel. The L and the R are the two secret vowels, you know, that they play the game with. Like the right and the left is really the light and the reft, right? The light and the reft. So, I just wanted to make sure I covered all those bases and hope that helped you out a little bit, T-Love, on trying to wrap your mind around all of this stuff. You have to, you know, listen to this for a while. You know, because, you know, nobody talks the metaphysics of our creation. They can't even begin to, because they're following the false narrative, you know, and that's really sad. And I've got to do one thing. So maybe, Shelly, you can just post a sign up there that has our schedule or the place where they can get the lost writings. And I'll be just giving, I got to put some vinyl over the window here. The sun's starting to come through, and I don't want to get that UVB and UVC radiation. And hey, and thank you, Just Love, for participating. Love to have you. And anybody who wants to call in, you know, you can do that. I'll be right back. I gotta block out the sunlight. It's a killer anymore. Hang on. Okay, and if you don't know that, then you're not watching Dane Wigington, who has geoengineeringwatch.org. You're not listening to the higher truth channel, the higher truth rises, and just go look at our featured on our homepage. Go look at the featured channels on the right, and you're gonna see where you can go to get up to speed on the fact that it's no longer safe to be in the sun, and it's no longer safe to walk in the rain. It's no longer safe outside, ladies and gentlemen, and it's the sad truth, okay? I've been following Dane Wigington for 10 years or more, and the Higher Truth is a naturopathic doctor and a family of physicists for three generations, and he spells out exactly what happens with the UVB and UVC on your body. You better be taking D3. You better be taking chlorophyll. You better be taking CoQ10. I recommend also sea veg, or you're going to have to take potassium iodine in a bottle, liquid. Okay, but you need to protect yourself from this harsh environment we're in now. Okay, it's like being in outer space. The ozone layer has been destroyed. The animals are dying. We're burning up. Okay, the plants right outside my apartment are half dead. The evergreen bushes are brown, half brown, dried up. You know, that's why this is really. Forgive me for being so honest, but, you know, this is really the ultimate, you know, the most important broadcast we have, because this is not our world, and therefore there's nothing here now. Okay, it's over, and we need to provide transcendence for our families. And so to make sense out of all of this is all that we have left to do, ladies and gentlemen, is to, you know, to be enlightened into the great mystery that nobody can define, because it's all being run by Jesuits and Freemasons. Okay? So let's be set free. And I'm giving you the keys, the tools, showing you how to read, and then you can see and read it for yourself. You don't need me anymore, but we're trying to spell it out. That's what we're doing. We're spelling it out here. What they've hidden from us. The code is broken. We pierced through the wall. The crack was there. We came through because Yeshua put the crack in the wall, because he's great. He can do it. Okay, and so now we're in the Gospel of the Essenes. Finally got there. Just took about 6 hours. That's okay, you know. I get on a roll and it's an egg roll, right? But just give me some sweet and sour along with it. That's the yin and yang, and we'll work it out. Okay, but yeah. So let me turn on a little light. Let there be a little more light. There it is. Yeah, that book was sold out of England, and then a Chinese company bought up that company there. And so this is now sold on the black market, so to speak, because they sell it for a high price on Amazon, you know. And so get it while before it's not, ladies and gentlemen. And Zakei, who is the translator, is a type of an insider. He went to the Vatican and stuff with his dad, and also into the Austrian library, where he found the writings of the Essenes. So. With the perspective of Zakei, I read some of his writings, you know, so I don't fully follow, what his ultimate perspectives were, because it may be that he was lacking, you know, he wasn't in the computer age and didn't have the benefit of all the information we do today. But, he read some books but didn't get the whole picture. But yet he was a translator, okay, and he wrote many books. So his work is to be respected. And he knows clearly that all of our translations, he admits in his prefaces of the Gospel of Peace of Jesus Christ, a book he sold for $1, you know, around the world and never upped the price. And then and this one, the Gospel of the Essenes, he's my second witness that our scriptures have been corrupted. It's nice to know somebody else can spell it out. You know, but I don't think he had all the answers to the dilemma. That was the thing. That's where, you know, we're in a vacuum. We are all in a vacuum. And it's just what the Father, Heavenly Father did with me is he put me at the right place at the right time to get the right picture and to keep collecting these original precepts of our diction, of the law of diction. You know, in other words, I may forget some of the small stuff, but when it came to remembering all the pieces of the puzzle about the diction, I didn't forget. And that's how he anointed me to know the truth about the diction. And it was the passion that I had. I knew the translations were corrupt. I wanted the original translation, transliteration, not translation. That's magic. Transliteration. Okay. And in fact, I have something on transliteration. I might as well do that as a primer. Since we're having the discussion, let me do that. Just a little piece. Hang on. Right back. Thank you. this was something I was going to file away, and then I just realized, well, gee, since it's out, let me grab it, okay? This is by Young. Young gave us the analytical concordance in the 1800s, while Strong's gave us a different type of concordance that was in a linear form. But the analytical concordance by Young, he also gave us the literal translation of the Bible. The Bible, the literal, literal. It's let me see here. It's Young's literal translation of the Bible. Yeah, and so it wouldn't be the fun read because it's literal in its the way it's conveying. And but he's a genius. He pointed out all of the problems. Okay, all the problems, and this will give you a little scope on it right here. So introduction: the modern day Bible translations, and I drafted this. I've just by reading Young and others, I pulled this together. So this is something that I wrote here, very short. Okay, introduction, the modern-day Bible translations, an expose on the problems in modern-day translations. I did this about 10 years ago. Excerpts from Robert Young of Young's Analytical Concordance to the Bible and Young's Literal Translation of the Holy Bible. The inspiration, now this is Young, the inspiration of the Bible extends only to the original text. Inspiration of the, and it's shofar, not Bible, shofar, extends, that's the soul fire, extends only to the original text, as it came from the pens of the original writers. Therefore, not to any of the translations, not to any of the translations ever made by man. So you know how people just want to eat up that King James, like it came down from the throne of the Son, but yet there are not any originals, and therefore we cannot say that any translations are truly inspired. Okay? In the sense that, well, they're all following the Babylonian code, right? They're all they didn't even consider the Indo-Germanic. That's the only distinction that is different with what I'm presenting is the original thought, which comes through the Indo-Germanic, that which was breathed into Hadam, and as that wonderful reference you brought out, Tiddly, on Strong 639, and that yeah, that was a good reference you have up there up in the deal. I'm going to pursue that a little bit. But so the translations, because what was breathed into the nostril is what is original, and that's what we're breathing in the Indo-Germanic, and all of the diction, all the letters are seeds of light. It all goes back to the light. That's what the code does. But what they blinded our eyes with the false code and the corrupt words, Eshavors, and therefore they put us into the darkness. Okay, so therefore, not to any of the translations ever made by man, however aged, venerable, or good, and only insofar as they adhere to the original. Well, there is no original, so it's a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy, neither adding to nor omitting from it one particle. Are they of any real value to the extent? To the extent that they vary from the original, the doctrine of verbal inspiration is lost. Okay, to the extent that they vary from the original, and in one sense, it's a theoretical impossibility to take something from Greek and put it into Latin, or take something from Hebrew and put it into English. Because you always lose when you go into another cultural form of writing, because they're not the same. And the way they meant something in a word, the idea, there's so many variables, it's just astronomical. Okay, and so the doctrine of verbal inspiration is lost as far as that version is concerned. A strictly literal rendering may not be so pleasant to the ear as one where the apparent sense is chiefly aimed at. Yet it is not euphony, but truth that ought to be sought. And where in such a version as the one commonly used in this country, that's Scotland, there are scarcely two consecutive verses where there is some departure, there are scarcely two consecutive verses where there is some departure from the original. Okay? And thank you, Lynn. Lynn was just sending me a Skype, and we hope Lynn, I haven't seen Lynn Mitzi for a while, and she has been a great support of this broadcast for the last year, and we're hoping she's okay there. And And such are those indicated, and such are the variations that may be counted by tens of thousands. Such are the variations that may be counted. In fact, it's open knowledge, an open secret, that there's like 20,000 outright misstatements and mistranslations within the King James, but it's more like, you know, twice that many, and it's more than that. The problem is worse than that. Okay, and so as admitted by on all hands, that, in other words, by scholars, those who can read and process and have done their homework, it is difficult to see how verbal inspiration can be of the least practical use to those who depend upon that version alone. Paraphrasing Robert Young, there is no future tense in the Hebrew. Future tense is expressed as present tense. You know, so as an example, like if 2,000 years in the Old Covenant, 2,000 BC, and then a star navigator, aka prophet, then says, you know, talking about Yeshua coming in the future, 2,000 years in the future, right? He didn't say he's coming. He would have said he has come. He has come. And that would be 2,000 years in advance of his actual coming. You see, because everything is an affirmative and it's as if it is already done. And then it's about present tense, and there is no future tense. And that's when you see that, then you know there's already a problem, okay? Already a problem. Somebody's altered, put it on sacred altar, and altered it. So other problems with translations, the Hebrew verb Nathan, as example, Nathan, N-A-T-H-A-N, sometimes also a noun, which is rendered by the King James translators in 67 different ways. 67 different ways. You call that a good translation? You know? And Nathan is Jonathan. We see it in Jonathan. And that was the one who David loved like his own, more than, you know, closer than a woman. The love, they said it was closer than a woman in the sense that there was something really going on here. And so maybe that's why his name was Jonathan. We should look at that right at the beginning point. But there's more, you know, to the story. Nathan, we can see the word nation. The word nation in Nathan, okay? So all of that. So the above final quote by Young expresses what cannot be if one is guided towards the truth in the scripture. It is impossible for one English word to do the business for 67 other Hebrew or Greek words. This expresses nothing other than a fraud, in all capital letters, in our modern day translations. Perhaps this is, and I'm the one who's speaking here, not Robert Young. Perhaps this is the reason King James had his lamp put out, which is an idiom meaning having his seed line cut off, which is what happened to his son, King Charles of England. He had his head cut off. Oh, let's keep that picture right there, Shelley. Thank you. Love it. Okay. And he had his head cut off. In other words, the evidence is that King James was cursed. King James was cursed. And because he was the one who claimed to be the great sovereign, as the introduction in the King James goes, he's now making out to be the sovereign. In essence, the King James, and it's occultic anyway, full of code. In essence, the King James Bible is merely a theft of intellectual property that was stolen from William Tyndale. The King James Version is in all actuality 90% William Tyndale, and all the King James Version translators had to do was to remove anything that had the potential to really set someone free from the government, and they didn't want that. The above statement is a fact of history that anyone can research for themselves, as I am looking at my copy of Tyndale in front of me as I make this statement. Another fact is that Tyndale's introduction is the most sophisticated introduction in all of modern translation history. Go read it. William Tyndale was, in essence, an enlightened intellectual genius. The only thing that the King James Version controllers had to do was to destroy the great work of Tyndale, cover its true origin, and then take credit for what was merely the illusion of religious freedom. And the enlightened only want the truth, and deep from the tree's root. It is all an open secret, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, and so there you go with that. Now let's get into the Gospel of the Essenes. And here we go. This is from the Essene Book of Moses, Moeshan, the Ten Commandments. Let me just take a sip of my throat tonic here. I know I get long-winded, ladies and gentlemen, but we got a lot of ground to cover. There's so much to talk about, you know? Okay, Just Love, you've got to run. So thank you for stopping by and for, you know, your participation. Always love having you. We're going to just – I'm not going to do the rest of what I was going to do here today. I'm going to cap it off with this so we don't have a cliffhanger. But we'll do part three. We'll do part three on Tuesday evening, okay? And very good. Yeah, we've been on for, what, 3 hours now? 45 minutes? Noon. Okay, so noon. We've been on for 2 hours and 41 minutes. That's your switch-out point right there, Just Love, okay? So here we are, from the Essene Book of Moshe, the Ten Commandments. And Mount Sinai, Eshene would be the correct term, but it's Sinai. That's sounds like cyanide, but it's Sinai. Means the eye that moved away. What Sinai literally means is the eye that, whereas Asha means royal eye, and then the Eshanel means the royal eye that came down. But Sinai, Eshene, AI. There's your AI right there, right? AI, okay, AI, and what it means, Sinai, the A is silent, so it's Sinai, but it literally means the darkness. Or the eye that went away. That's what it means, the eye that went away. So there you go. When your eye goes away, you can't see anymore, right? So at Mount Eshene, or Sinai, it was altogether in smoke because the Yahweh descended upon it in fire, and the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of a furnace. And the whole mount quaked greatly. And the Yahweh came down from Mount Sinai and on top of the mountain. It came down upon the mountain of Sinai and on top of the mountain. And the Yahweh called to Moshe up to the top of the mountain, and Moshe went up. And the Yahweh called to Moshe out of the mountain, breathing, "Come unto me, for I would give you a law for your people, and which will be a covenant, for the seed of light." Literally says children of light. That's the seed of light. Those are the ones who become like the stars of heaven, right? And Moshe went up unto Yahweh, and Yahweh spoke all of these Eshavors, breathing, "I am the law." That would be the pure shelter. The pure shelter is the law. You can't open a shell with your bare hands. It's protection. "I am the pure law, your great Dul of Haim, which has brought you out from the depths of bondage and darkness." That was Mitzar, Egypt. And you will have no other laws before me, no foreign law. You will not make unto you any image of the law in the throne of the sun, nor in the earth beneath, no images. I am the invisible law, without beginning, without end. And you will not make unto you false laws, for I am the law. I am the pure shelter, and the whole pure shelter of all laws. They corrupted the word shelter into shitar. The Jews did. They made the shitar, and they made it a contract law. But the original word for shitar is shelter. Okay, and that's how they corrupted it. If you forsake me, let me back up here. And you shall not make unto you any images of the law in heaven and earth, and I am the invisible law without beginning and without end. You will not make unto you false laws, for I am the law and the whole law of all laws, the shelter of all shelters. That's right, the sovereign of all sovereigns. If you forsake me, you will be visited by disasters for generation upon generation. And if you keep my mandates, my commandments, and you shall enter the infinite garden, that's the light. The earth is not the infinite garden. That's back to the light. That's the atom, which is a symbol. It's beyond the atom. It's beyond the sun. But the sun is the great logo. Okay? Where stands the tree of life? Well, there's the symbol of the tree of life as well, in the light. In the center of the eternal sea, in the center of the sea is the sun. Okay? It is the sun at the center of the cosmic sea. Okay, they're all bobbing up and down in the cosmic waters, right? No bottom, no top, bottomless pit. You will not violate the law. The law is your great Dole of Hame, who will not hold you guiltless. Honor your earthly mother, that your days may be long upon the land, and honor your great father who rules from the throne of the sun, that your that eternal life, not eternal, but eternal, tornal life be yours in your son, your soul. For the earth and the stars are given unto you by the pure shelter, which is the great Dole of Hame. Okay, so the message in the stars, and it is all Elohim. It is the lower creation, but it speaks of the higher order of things. You will greet your earthly mother on the morning. Got to get my Germanic on here. It's not morning. It's Morgan. In the Morgan, that's the mother's light of the garden. In the Morgan of the Eshavat. The Eshavat is the serpent that goes round. The serpent going round back to the sun on the Saturday. It goes back to the sun day, the Saturn's day. The Saturn means the soul turn, to turn back to the sun, which is where we have to go. You will greet the natural forces of the earth in the second Morgan. And you will greet the Malak of life on the third Morgan. And you will greet the royal messenger of joy on the fourth Morgan, and in the mother's garden. And you will greet the royal messenger of the sun on the fifth royal garden. And you will greet the royal messenger of the viator, the water, on the sixth Morgan. And you will greet the royal messenger of the air on the seventh Morgan. So on the seventh represents the air, which represents spirit, and going back to that which was from the beginning. All the royal messengers of the earthly mother will you greet. And we are royal messengers, by the way, okay? So it's euphemistic, because nature is a royal messenger. Nature is Elohim. And we are supposed to be enlightened, therefore Elohim, you see. So all of these royal messengers of the earthly mother, you will greet and consecrate yourself before them, that you may enter the infinite Ganun. That's the garden at high noon, where stands the tree of life at high noon. That's the sun, okay? Where all of everything came out of the light. You will pay homage unto the great father of light who rules from his throne in the sun on the evening of the Eshavat, the Sabbath. That's Eshavat. You will commune with the royal messenger of eternal life on the second evening. And you will commune with the royal messenger of work on the third evening. And you will commune with the royal messenger of the Eshalom of eternal peace on the fourth evening. And you will commune with the royal messenger of power on the fifth evening. And you will commune with the royal messenger of love on the sixth evening. And you will commune with the royal messenger of, and it could be plural as well, royal messengers of wisdom on the seventh evening. And all these royal messengers of the great father of light who rules from his throne in the sun, you will commune with. So that would imply our brothers and sisters. It would imply the scriptures. It would imply reflecting on nature, because it is, the wisdom is everywhere. Like we talked about Sophia, right? We talked about it. And so we have to see things in the true light here. And so all the royal messengers of the great father who rules from his throne in the sun will you commune with, all of them. In other words, everything is to be considered, because he made all things. Everything is speaking. Even the occult are dressed up in the light, right? Lucifer is clothed in light, even though she's a whore. She looks pretty good for, you know, her whoredom, right? She's the woman on Columbia Records, Columbia Pictures, Statue of Liberty, all, you know, she's looking pretty good, but she's a whore. And so commune with all of these things, that your soul bathe in the fountain of light. Bathe in the fountain of light. That's the river of light. See, out of the garden came the river of light, the garden of the atoms. The flowing light came down, parted into the four directions. That's the fourth, north, south, east, and west. Not a literal river, but a river of light. And the names of the river, as Philo pointed out, were symbolic. And enter into the cosmic sea of eternity. The seventh Dayel is the Eshavat, the Sabbath. You will remember it. That is, but he talked about the eternal rest, as we find in Hebrews. You have ceased from your own works, in other words, right? And keep it pure. And the Eshavat is the Dayel of the light of the pure shelter, the law, thy great Dulafheim, referring to the sun again. In it you will not do any work. We're in the daytime, right? But search the light, the royal domain in the great house of the sun, of the pure judgment of light, of the great Dulafheim, and all things will be given unto you. And yeah, I am transliterating as I'm reading. I'm transliterating into the Indo-Germanic because it's so more powerful when we go back to original thought. And you get the book yourself, you can get it and read the watered down version, because even Zakei, who gave us the translation, wasn't up on the Indo-Germanic. You know, that's why we're doing it here, because I want you to breathe, you know, the essence of this pure diction that is so provides, you know, pictures, you know, it's beautiful. You will not take the life of any living thing. Life comes. So there's doing away with the sacrifices, right? No more sacrifices. Just Love missed this one because she would have loved to hear this right here, that you will not take the life from any living thing. Okay. Life comes only from Yahweh, who is the great Dulafheim, who gives it and has the power to take it away. You will not debase love. It is the sacred gift of the great Father of Light, who rules from the throne of the sun. And you will not trade your shul. You will not trade your soul, meaning you will not trade your light, the priceless gift of the loving great Dulafheim, for the riches of the world, which are as seeds sown on stony ground, having no root in themselves, and so enduring but for a little while. You will not be a false witness of the pure shelter of the law, to use it against your brother. I guess that throws Freemasonry out the window, right? A bunch of liars. Only the great Dulafheim knows the beginning and the ending of all things, for his eye is single. That's right, his eye is one, as we see in the great logo of the sun. And he is the only true anointed, pure shelter of light on the wind and wings of fire throughout all time. The pure shelter. You will not covet your neighbor's possessions, the pure shelter of the law given unto you much greater gifts. Even that's called the treasure in heaven, which is the treasure in the throne of your son. The knowledge of the three, sun, earth, and moon, the three of creation, the stars over Orion's belt, okay? The knowledge of who we are, where we are, when we are, and why we are, and what are you going to do about it, ladies and gentlemen? Even the earth and the sun and the moon and the stars are the great treasures that are yours if you keep the royal judgments. That's commandments. Royal judgments. Jeez, I finally got the proper statement for that. Commandments are the royal judgments. Let me just write this down. I should have had that aspect of it. I've been calling them mandates, royal judgments. You're getting it here first, ladies and gentlemen. Commandments, Commandments. And the etymology on the word is worth looking up and into the other cultural, you know, translations, because we are, obviously they didn't use these words back then, right? Commandments, you know, it's like a military command, but you know, that's not the way he did it. It was by love, right? It's by love that these things came down to us. So these are more like mandates, but royal judgments. That's really what they are. They're the royal judgments. If you do these things, you will be like royalty, you know, to rule your own soul and to rule as a sovereign upon the earth, because the only true sovereignty is within the light, right? And this is the law of light. Okay, so and so I'm backing up here. And you shall not be a false witness and use it against your brother. And you shall not cover your brother's possessions, the law given unto you much greater gifts, even the sun, earth, and moon, and the stars, if you will keep the royal judgments of the Yahweh, who is the great Dulafheim. And Moeshan heard the voice of the Yahweh, who is the great Dulafheim, and sealed within him the covenant that was between the Yahweh and the seed of light. He sealed the covenant, okay, with him. in stone, written in stone. And Moishan turned and went down from the mountain. And remember, this is the first tablets, right? That's what was on the first tablets, what we just read. It wasn't so blatant, you know, thou shalt not do this, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this. You heard what I just read, right? Take note of it. And the tablets, and so Moishan turned and he went down from the mountain, and the two tablets of the law of the pure shelter, were in his hand. That's the original word for law, pure shelter. It's a protection. It's not a wall. Law is wall backwards. Not a wall. It's a protection. And the tablets were the work of the great Dolofheim. That's Yeshua. Yeshua is the great Dolofheim, distinction between the word Lord and the word God. And the writing was the writing of the great Dolofheim, graven upon the tablets. And so Moishan met Yeshua on the mountain, of course. And Tuesday, we'll do the transfiguration out of the Gospel of the Perfect Life to compare, okay? That'll be coming up in part three. We're going to do a part three here. And the tablets were the work of the great Dolofheim. And Moses turned and went down, and the law was in his hand. And the tablets were the work of the great Dolofheim, and the writing was the writing of the great Dolofheim on the tablets. And the people knew not what became of Moishan. And they gathered themselves together and brake off their golden earrings and made a molten calf, a bull, excuse me. Again, the lie is continually perpetuated. It was a bull. We know it's a bull that represented the earth, the pagan traditions. They were full of it. That's why we get papal bulls. And they worshipped unto the idol and offered it to burnt offerings. Offered the burnt offerings to the bull, to the idol. They loved the bull. And they ate and drank and danced before the golden calf, the bull, and which they had made. And they abandoned themselves to corruption and blindness. And right before Yahweh, and it came to pass, as soon as he came near unto the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing and the wickedness of the people. And Moishan's anger waxed hot, and he threw the tablets out of his hands and brake them on beneath the mountain. And it came to pass on the morrow, that Moishan said unto the people, you have closed your eyes, and it is a great blindness. You have denied your archogenitor, your creator, and I will go up unto the Yahweh and plead atonement for your blindness. And Moishan returned up to the Yahweh, and he said, Yahweh, you have seen the desecration of your pure anointed pure law, your pure shelter, for your seed of your seed have lost their victory of light, and pay homage unto the darkness, to the bull, and have made for themselves a golden bull. Yahweh, forgive them, for they are blind to your light, your great light. And the Yahweh said unto Moishan, you must see and read it for yourself. At the beginning of time was a covenant made between the Yahweh and the Eshan, the man, and the only true anointed pure great flame of light on the wings of fire of the great architect, the Elohim, did enter into him, and he was made a Zan of Yahweh, who is the great Dolofheim. And it was given unto him to guard his inheritance, like the fire of the sun is guarding the center of paradise of the firstborn, and to make fruitful the land of his father, and to keep it pure. And he who cast out the creator from him doth spit upon his own birthright, and no more grievous a blindness does exist in the eyes of Yahweh, who is the great Dolofheim. And the Yahweh spoke, breathing, only the seed of light can keep the mandates of the pure shelter. Give me your ear, for I say this, the tablets which you did break, these will never more be written in the Ash of Ors of Eshan, in the words of men. And you did return them to the earth of and fire, and so they will live invisible in the hearts of those who are able to follow after the pure shelter, the Trevain law. To your people of little victory of light, who did close their eyes against the archogenitor, the creator, even whilst you stood on pure anointed ground of enlightenment before your great Elohim, and I will give, therefore, another law. It will be a stern law. Yeah, it will bind them, for they do not yet know the royal domain of the light. And Moeshan hid the invisible law within his breast, within his heart, and he kept it as a sign for the seed of light and that were to come. And the great Elohim gave unto Moeshan the written law for the people, and he went down unto them, and he spake unto them with a heavy heart. And Moeshan said to the people, these are the laws which your great Elohim hath given unto you. You shall have no other Elohim before me. You will not make unto you any graven image. You will not take the royal title of the Yahweh, your great Elohim, in vain. Remember the Eshavat, the Savat, the Shabbat Dayel, to keep it pure. Honor your father and your mother. And that includes the cosmic mother and the great father of light. You will not commit murder. You will not commit adultery. You will not steal. You will not bear false witness against your neighbor. And you will not covet your neighbor's house, nor your neighbor's wife, nor anything that is your neighbor's. And there was a Dayel of great mourning, and an atonement for the great blindness against the archogenitor, which did not end. And the broken tablets of the invisible law were hidden in the breast of Moeshan, Moses, until it came to pass in the seed of light. That's what Yaakoveh represented. That's the word Yaakoveh is seed of light, Jacob, seed of light. They corrupted it. And it appeared, and as it appears in the desert, when the voice was crying in the wilderness, and the pure anointed messenger then came to walk on earth. That's Yeshua, the pure anointed messenger, breathing the light of truth from the tree's root. And there you have the from the Gospel of the Essenes, ladies and gentlemen, the 10 royal judgments, also known as commandments. They are royal judgments because you are the one to judge whether you wish to follow. You're nobody's forcing you to follow. It is your call. It is, you are the judge, okay? So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen, the forbidden history, what they didn't want you to know, that we tell right here. If anybody wants to call in, you can call in on the hotline. It's very hot, 608-566-7295. Okay, love to take a call if you want to do a follow-up with a question or two or have a comment. Love to hear from you. Or if you want to call in on Skype, then that's Forbidden History Live. I'm willing to stay on for a little bit if we're trying to wrap our mind around anything. Okay, we're trying to make lemonade out of the lemons they gave us, and we can do that. You know, we can actually unravel the mystery, as the scriptures say. There's nothing hidden that cannot be revealed. There's nothing in secret that cannot be known. It is actually meant to be known. The occult actually in their own blindness serve the great spirit of life. They're the dogs from that standpoint, you know, like, come here, puppy, you know, and they're the dogs, the priesthood of the occultic service, because they're preserving the baby. The baby comes to us in a corrupt form. It is the darkness that we see first before we came into the darkness, and then we see the light shining and say, oh, look at, there's a star up there. It's called the sun, and it's shining down every day, and it represents something, but nobody knew the meaning anymore because they didn't tell us in school. They weren't telling us in religions or, you know, the bull pits, full of bull, aren't they? And so we have to see and read things for ourselves, ladies and gentlemen, and we have to then know how to read, and we have to become symbologists. We have to put on the metaphors and become the metaphor, become seed of light. That's what we, not be like seed of light, but become seed of light in the reality of the truth. Put on the perfection of light, what is denied by mainstream Christianity, lamestream would be a better way to say it, Christianity, that says, well, you can never be perfect because, you know, yeah, and you're always going to sin, you're always going to be a screw-up, you can't live up to that standard. Well, wait a minute, I thought Yeshua showed us the way, showed us what will be the, you know, in other words, when he said it is finished on the, when he nailed his serpent up to the cross and he said it is finished, that's when he had finished the whole cycle of creation. In other words, it wasn't about the physical form, but it was about our spirit. that we would be transformed from corruption into incorruption. Well, obviously, you know, or as it gave the example of the perfect fruit versus the corrupt fruit. You know a tree by its fruit. A perfect fruit does not bring forth corrupt fruit, and the corrupt tree cannot bring forth perfect fruit. You're either one or the other. You see, it's not, oh, they're kind of like, you know, the same tree, and they got a little bit of corrupt fruit there and a little bit of good perfect fruit over here. No, it's one or the other. It said either make the tree corrupt or make it perfect. You know, one or the other. You can't have a little bit of pregnancy, right? You can't be a little pregnant. You're either pregnant or you're not pregnant, right? One or the other. And so you can't have a little corruption and a little bit of perfection. You know, you can't have a little truth and a little bit of lie. The truth is not a part of any lie, it says, right? Yeah. And so, we're right up at high noon on the Pacific coast now. We started at high noon on Eastern Seaboard. And you know, your problem is you never call in. You know, we need to get some callers. This is a caller program. That's what we do here. We take calls because I want to be able to help you on your journey. Okay. I'm still working on myself. I'm still having things open up to me. Nobody, not one of us will ever know everything because it's infinite, you know, but, and Crystal says, Crystal.LeeKeith. Oh, okay. You're giving out emails, I guess. But you know, I'm getting hungry. I got some burritos waiting for me, and I gotta get on that stove, I guess, because, Ninja is putting out the signal. Give a call. You're all good. Okay. I never imagined we could have such a wonderful, gathering of people and such a great broadcast thanks to, several ladies that just really got inspired and are producing this work, NinjaCat111 and Yo Shelly G U. That's, I guess, that Yo Shelly G University. She's now got a college. Okay, that's outstanding. It's getting better all the time, isn't it? Yeah. Well, you know what they do when you go to college? Lunch break. Chidley, that's right. So you know when you go to college, you know what you got to give them at the door? You got to give them your tuition. Oh, and that's your intuition, right? The tuition is the intuition. Okay. So yeah, no free thinking. It's all under the auspices of the Vatican. All universities, the universitas, have their license from the Vatican. Okay, it's one think, one stink. Okay, and that's the one world odor. The one stink is the one world odor, and so it's very tragic, ladies and gentlemen. You know, very tragic because our families are being brainwashed, right? And we're the deprogramming program right here. So Crystal's going to work on her Skype, it looks like. That'd be great. And we love to have some friends join in, you know, just to, I like the spontaneity of questions, you know, because I never know where it's going to take us, and we might actually see something for the first time as well. And that way, Saint Desert, why does it say in the scriptures to die is gain, and if a man loses his life, he will find it, and if an Ashan finds his life, he will lose it. And okay, and then now we've got mom overy acting. Okay, and welcome to the broadcast. Because we have to lose our life. In other words, when we came into the world, we think that, like, you know, when we have little ones, right, children, you know, there you go, the word killed and chilled. When we have children, then we think that we gave them life, right? But no, we didn't give them life. We gave them death. And so our, what we have, we call a life, is an illusion, because we know that the end is coming, right? That which has a beginning has an end. We know that we have to meet an interminable doom called death. And that's the second death. The first death is our spirit alienation from the great light. We have been alienated from the light in our first round. And so that's why we have to go a second round, and that's to be born again, which is called becoming the second born. And so we have to die metaphysically. It's a metaphysical process, a state of being, dying to this world, and then to put on the light, and which is becoming the second born. Lazarus, come forth. Ray of light, come forth. Right? What do we say about that one, right? Where is that card? Lazarus, come forth. Realize, realize. The Lazars, realize. Put on the realize, the Ulezar, and then become the second born. And so if you don't do that, then you forfeit your opportunity that you have right here, okay, to be reborn. Reborn is to be the second born. But that which came last in the second round is like that which was actually at the beginning, before creation came to be. It's going full circle back, and that's in the spirit, because flesh and matter are the illusion and is the temporary jar. It's all to be destroyed. So it is a house, the mother's carrying the baby, and it is the baby is the spirit, and the spirit is behind everything, and the spirit is masculine. And that's why the man appears bigger than the woman, because the spirit only can make something below himself, and it is a lower creation. That's why woman got the bad rap, when actually guys were all in the fall together, and we need each other in the transformation of our being. But woman, because she is the symbol of the lower creation of the Elohim, she gets the bad rap. But the man is there with her, but he is supposed to be the guy going out getting the bacon of truth, and exposing Francis Bacon, a.k.a. Shakespearean, King James Version. Go to Psalm 46, count down 46 words, and you get shake, and you go to Psalm 46 and count up from the bottom, and you get spear, and there's your Shakespeare, King James Version, because they standardized our English at the same time with the King James Version, because all English, Middle English, was all homogenized between French, Norman, and Anglo-Saxon, and German, and you know, and it was just so they used the King James by getting it in every community to standardize the English, because they knew they were going to use English also as the one world form of communication. That's why everybody around the world, from China to Germany, and you know, where Russia, all you know, learn English as the second language, because it's a one world communication system, right? They did that. They engineered it. It's all engineered. There's nothing by accident, nothing grassroots. It's all a pre-designed one-world fabrication. Yeah, so we have to be the second born, ladies and gentlemen, and be set free from the world and recognize that we are eternal beings. And so there's no call coming in, and so I think then it's a wrap. I want to thank you all for tuning in today. Oh, and Zealot's got something here. Amen. And God bless. My jar is still having issues. Need to run. Thank you for another awesome lesson. And thank you for stopping by, Zealot, also. And be well out there. Another one who's felt the pain of our planet and the thorns and thistles of this world. And that's milk thistle, by the way. The milk thistle is the symbol of International Freemasonry, the milk thistle with all those thorns and the spines, while it's got that purple bulb right in the middle, and you can't touch it because of all those thorns. They think they're the ultraviolet light, but Yeshua is the ultraviolet light, right? And can you break down the word family? Well, the fame ally, you know, I don't know, you know, the etymology, on the surface, it's... you know, we see the fae, the fame allay, the fam, the, you know, the fae of light. It could, you know, like the word wife is wife fae, the vae fae, the way of the fae, the way of the woman. Wife is the way of the woman of creation, the beauty of creation. The woman, you know, even though she gets a bad rap, she still gets complimented for her beauty and for, you know, the woman that a man is attracted to, the spirit of man is attracted to the female spirit. And I don't know what attracts the woman to the man, you know, but so it's not clearly defined. I'd have to look it up on the etymology and dictionaries, but the fae, female, familiar. We see, oh, okay, on the surface, the word family, we can see F-A-M-I-L-Y. Just saw it, and I've seen it before, but I forgot. We see the word F-A-M-I-L-Y. A-R. Is that how you spell it? Familiar, right? So the family is familiar, right? These are the ones that we grew up with, the ones that we know. And so they are my familiars, those who I know who know me, okay? So that's on the surface, but the word fae is in there, And interesting in familiar, you can almost see the word liar. But the mal is in there, the femal yar. So the word, you know, that which goes round, we all go around, we walk everywhere we go, right? So those are the elements that are in there. It's not an easier one to define based on the Indo-Germanic, but there it is. Okay, so I think we've done enough damage for one day, ladies and gentlemen. And I know that Gandhi Bandi Rashish Hashish is really upset with me on sitting in his loincloth in his cave in India, the Brahman Zabram, you know, that are running our world, and they are an unseen hand. Okay, we'll never see who they are. We won't know their names or their faces. But they work out of the Vatican. They work out of banking. They work out of the Queen's house in England. You know, she's the great symbol. That's why she don't have a king. You have to ask yourself, how come the Queen doesn't have Prince Philip isn't called a king? Because the Queen is the symbol. She's the most, you know, represents the most powerful piece. The Queen, the Eastern Star Witch. The Eastern Star Witch, you know, out of the East. In the Orient, that's where we get our orientation from. If we go back to the East, that's where we'll figure this stuff out, you know, because we follow an Eastern culture, what we call is as Christianity. It comes from the East, but they put it in the West, and West means dead. The West, West is dead. The sun set, you see. And so, okay, Ninja, very good. So anyway, I'm talked out, actually, ladies and gentlemen. So thank you again for stopping by. And I'm just so grateful to get to know so many wonderful people on our cyber world of the internet. And so just don't forget, all right, I'm Desert Owl telling you that if you want to know the future, then you need to look for the forbidden history, because it's all right here. You know it's what they didn't want you to know that we tell right here. And so do tell a friend, won't you? Let's have a revolution in thinking. And look for us on Ninja Cat 111 tomorrow at 10 a.m. Eastern Time. For what they didn't want you to know, that we'll play again, Sam. We'll see you. Thanks for tuning in. And for telling your friends.
Paint your palette blue and gray. Look out on a summer's day with eyes that know the darkness in my soul. Shadows on the hills. Sketch the trees and the daffodils. Catch the breeze and the winter chills in colors on the snowy linen land. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen. Did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now. Starry, starry night. Flaming flowers that brightly blaze. Swirling clouds in violet haze reflect in Vincent's eyes of china blue. Colors changing hue. Morning fields of amber grain, weathered faces lined in pain, are soothed beneath the artist's loving hand. Now I understand what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now, for they could not love you. But still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful as you. Starry, starry night. portraits hung in empty halls, frameless heads on nameless walls, with eyes that watch the world and can't forget, like the strangers that you've met. The ragged men in ragged clothes, a silver thorn, a bloody rose, lie crushed and broken on the virgin snow. Now I think I know what you tried to say to me, and how you suffered for your sanity, and how you tried to set them free. They would not listen, they're not listening still. Perhaps they never